Divine Truth. Name of this presentation is Discussions with Fearful Spirits, and it is part of Spirit Relationships series. It was presented in Philadelphia, USA on the 20th of July, 2012.
No worries. Well, I think it's pretty close to time to start, isn't it? Well, probably what we'll do today is, to be honest, we're not sure what we're going to do today, but I'll just give you a bit of a time frame so that you know when you'll be let out of here. We're hoping to finish before 9 o'clock tonight, so that way you can get a decent night's sleep tonight. We've had a fairly busy day already. We've been doing some interviews this afternoon about the subject of Mormons, the Mormon religion, which you'll see probably on the YouTube. It'll probably be quite a few weeks' time, actually, because after we leave here, we've got to get all the data off the cameras, and then what we're doing is sending it back to Australia for the guys to master it, and then it will find its way to YouTube sometime. But it was a very good interview we had today, and we'll be continuing it tomorrow morning at 10 as well. So there's a fairly busy tomorrow for us as well. But tonight, the plan we had was to actually do some mediumship with some spirits who have been following us around for a long time. A lot of the spirits have been following us around for over a year or so now, waiting for an opportunity to talk. And we thought that some of you, since some of you are mediums and so forth, you might be interested in just engaging that process with us. Mary's going to do some mediumship for us tonight. And we also will find that probably a lot of the spirits we speak to have a very similar emotional condition that many of you may find that you have. So we can discuss the emotions involved for some of them as well through that process. So that's what we're going to do tonight. We may find actually that we engage this in a very similar way tomorrow as well. So we're not certain tomorrow yet about the subjects we want to talk about. And so we may finish up talking to some spirits as well tomorrow and then basing our conversation that we have with you on what we discuss with them. Tonight, feel free to ask any questions you would like, and don't be afraid to do that. Who of you feel afraid to do that? Okay. So, yeah, we're in Australia, we're all used to that now, so everyone's pretty... You can tell by the questions, they get more and more personal, the less afraid everybody becomes.
Everyone's forgotten there's a camera.
Yeah, that's right. So I'd just like to encourage you to do that, because that also engages not only your own self, but also any spirits who would like to ask questions through you have the opportunity to ask those questions when you're engaged like that. So, and quite a few may like to do that tonight. So we'll see how that progresses tonight.
Do you want to say our program for the weekend? Have we decided it properly? Which
I think we've pretty much decided on the timing, haven't we?
Yeah.
So, yeah, probably.
So we'll be here, obviously, this evening, and then tomorrow from 1 till 6, and Sunday 1 till 6 as well. And we might try to arrange like a group meal on Saturday night just at a local restaurant. So tomorrow we'll ask you if you would like to come and we can make a reservation. Hopefully you'll have the chance to get to know each other a bit as well, because I've spoken, there's people from Mexico and Canada and all the lots of different states as well, so it'd be great for you guys to get to know each other as well.
And we'd like to welcome you here.
Yes.
And we look forward to spending a bit of time with you over the weekend. You looking forward to that too?
Yes.
With each other? That's good. No worries. Well, Mary and myself, we've been, since the last time we saw so many of you, we've only been home about 3 and a bit weeks. In between that time, we've been travelling, so we rarely get to go home nowadays, it seems. And the last time we were home was just before we came on this trip. We were home for 6 days, getting ready for the trip. Before then, we visited a lot of places in Australia. We flew to some places and drove to others. And so since the last time we saw you here in the States, we've travelled around quite a lot at home. But on this trip, we went via England first, and we went up to Sweden. And the guys in Sweden are starting up a God's Way of Love Learning Centre up there, right on the Arctic Circle. And so when we went up there, it was day all the time. So we had jet lag and it was day all the time. So if you can imagine, we're quite tired as a
and
result of that.
We were in England, then we flew from England, so we're kind of on some kind of strange English Australian time now.
Yeah. But it was really interesting in Sweden because the last time we were there, it was just in the sort of depths of winter. The snow was like this high and it was about minus 15 or so. Very dry, and of course with that amount of snow it sort of covers all the landscape. And then we went up there this time and it was like buzzing with life. It was just an amazing place. Daylight all the time, and insects and birds and animals everywhere, and
it's like going to a different place.
So it was a very interesting time. The guys in Gothenburg said that they would like to pass on their love to the next group that we met, so that's you guys. So we're pleased to do that. Then we came back via England, and we only had 2 days, two full days in England. But one of those evenings, we had a chat with a small group of 15 people about a subject that many of you will probably at some point want to watch. It was called Sincerity or Hypocrisy, was the subject of the talk there. And we had a very good chat, actually, with that small group, because it was quite a small group, it's quite intimate, and we managed to actually have quite a lot of very good interactions as a result of that. And then we flew from there straight to here. We got here last night, so that's been our travel so far. From here, we go down to Barbados. We're catching up with some friends that I've had there since 2004, and so we're catching up with them. And then there will be doing some discussions there as well to around 50 or 60 people probably is what were there last time. And then we go to Brazil, and we'll be in Brazil for three weeks. So that's our plan, and then after Brazil, we're home again. So there's three cities at the moment planned in Brazil as well. So that's where we're going around the world. And it's all courtesy of a few people in Australia who donated all the funds for us to travel. So you might like to thank them for that. Yep. Okay.
Sitting.
Other than that, we'll get straight into it, shall we?
I'm actually going to put the coat on my legs.
It's pretty cool, isn't it, too?
Yeah.
Mary's worried about modesty. Doesn't want the camera seeing upper skirts. Are there any questions you'd like to ask before we start about what we're going to do? We're happy to answer any questions first. If you can bear in mind with any channeling, it's very important that you remain quite open emotionally rather than judgmental to the spirits who will come, because some of them will come and you will think, well, why don't they get that, or why don't they understand that, or that doesn't make much sense, and you'll have a lot of different feelings perhaps come up as a result. And what we'd like to do is make sure that they just are, you know, don't have to wade their way through all of those emotions in order to speak with Mary. And so what I'm going to do is discuss things with those spirits, and hopefully help them. They've been waiting for assistance for quite some time. So I'd like to be able to share with them things about the truth. And then you'll find in this discussion that it may bring up questions for you about specific emotions that you might have that are similar to the spirits, or it may bring up questions about the spirit world that you've had that you feel confused about because of what they've said about the channeling or what they've said to us. So if that's the case, our suggestion is just write them down. I think the lovely people who have given us the venue have given us a little notepad and a piece of paper as well. So just write down any question you might have. And then what we'll do once we've stopped speaking with those spirits, we'll try to address any of those questions that you might have as well, so that we can answer most of the questions that may come up. There's quite a lot of groups of spirits who have been waiting to speak with us. But this particular group of spirits is a group of women who you could say are on a spiritual path in the spirit world. You could say they're New Agers, I suppose you could call them. They believe in a lot of, you know, New Age principles that you would have learned about on Earth. But they want to talk to us about change with regard to fear. So they, in particular, want to talk about fear. So that's about all I think we need to introduce, and then we'll get ourselves started.
Okay. Hello.
Hello.
My name is Tiffany, and I have come. I'm representing a group of women here, and firstly, we're pleased to have this opportunity to speak with you.
When you say you're representing a group of women, is there a lot of women with you?
Yes, we are some. We are a large group. Some 20,000 of us, although our numbers are waxing and waning a little today, for many of us are undecided if we wish to have this conversation.
Right. Yep.
We have seen much of what you do, and we recognise there is some wisdom in what you teach. However, many of us have concerns about this emotional process. And many of us have some concerns that the progress we have gained since passing will be lost through this process.
So you're worried that if you engage in an emotional process of working your way through different emotions that are still there from Earth time, that if you do that, that you'll actually lose the progress that you've made so far in the spirit world.
Well, there is some confusion about whether these emotions still exist within us.
Right, okay.
We have logically seen that since we passed, we were taught a number of things from various different people. But for myself, if I can speak for myself,
sure.
I was taught by someone who was a monk, a Tibetan monk, who taught me about the power of controlling my emotions, my fears. This assisted me greatly when I passed. And I have a number of questions about this process, because now it seems that you would have us do the reverse, and yet the process I engaged at his under his instruction helped me a great deal to brighten my conditions.
Yep.
When I passed, I found myself in a very frightening place.
Could you describe it a little for us?
It was dark and cold.
Yep.
I found myself exposed in a kind of wilderness. I felt very frightened and alone of what would come and attack me, who would come, and at times I could hear and sense people in the surrounding area, and it was as if I was frozen. Yes,
but it was very dark and lonely place.
Yes, and I have some difficulty now speaking with you about it, because this challenges the sense of calm I feel I have achieved.
Right. Can I just ask a little bit more background, and then we can proceed with the feelings that are present. So how long ago were you on Earth? Do you mind me asking?
60 years ago I passed from Earth.
And did anybody tell you how long you were in that dark, cold place?
No, I have not inquired.
What did it feel like for you? Like, in terms of how long did it feel like?
some length of time, however, not perhaps now I'm being given guidance, it was only some months.
Right. So you only spent a few months in that location and then somebody came along to assist you with your fear. Is that?
Yes.
Yeah. And that person was a Tibetan monk who basically taught you that the way that you could get out of the current location you're in was to learn how to control your fear or learn how to not respond to your fear. Is that what he taught you?
Yes, he taught me a technique to not pay regard to these feelings, mm-hmm. and it seemed miraculous. I had never had contact with such a person before, someone so exotic, mm-hmm. and in the simple way that he showed me, he visibly showed me a technique with my spirit, what I know now is my spirit body.
Yep.
To contain the emotion. And immediately that I did this, I found myself in a better place.
In a better location in the spirit world.
Yes, it was warmer, brighter immediately.
Yes.
And I found that if I continued to practice this technique, things became better. Mm-hmm. And eventually I came to have associates around me and even now friends. Many of us who are here now are friends. Mm-hmm. But our difficulty comes because we realize that this process is not working as well as it used to.
When you say it's not working as well as it used to, can you sort of describe from the beginning it seemed like it was quite a rapid change, and then is it now slowing down? Is that what's really happening, where you're having to try harder but you seem to be having less progress?
Well, the issue is that many of us now do not feel that we're afraid.
Yep.
We feel quite calm. We feel there is some pleasantries in our surroundings. Mm-hmm. But there is a frustration that it seems that we cannot gain more. We cannot brighten our circumstance further. And it feels flat.
Right. And when you describe, can you describe your surroundings now? Just for the sake of the people that are listening.
It is a fairly normal, from what I... It is not so different from my life on Earth.
Right. So it had sun, it has a light.
Yes.
Colour.
We have houses. We have a community of us dwelling here.
Yeah. And when you cast your mind back to the first moments that you arrived in the spirit world, what did you have colour then, or did you have a house then?
Black.
No? Black.
Alone.
You couldn't see anything, any light really. And when this man, it was a man came to you?
Yes.
Yes. When this man came to you, he was quite bright, wasn't he?
Yes.
Yeah. And then
brighter than we are now. And
yes, yes. And has he come to you, ever visited you since? Since he showed you that original technique?
Yes, he came to me over time, and I learned to perfect the technique. Or can I say we thought we had perfected this technique?
Yep.
And now...
Now you're not sure whether you've perfected it?
No, because we seem unable to attain the level of peace that he had and he displayed, and the brightness in his body.
Did you ever ask him how long it had taken him to obtain his level of peace?
No.
No.
If we can take a moment, because this, one of the problems that we have when speaking with you, and this is what has caused much of the dissent amongst our group today, mm-hmm. is that we feel immediately that things begin to change in us and our surroundings change. We do not understand.
And are your surroundings changing in a positive direction?
No.
No, they're getting back dark again.
Yes.
Yes. And this is your concern.
Yes, and there are many of us now who feel perhaps we should stop speaking.
Yeah, I understand. Can I just reassure you, firstly, that if you continue to practice the same techniques as you've always practiced since you've arrived in the spirit world, then you will have no trouble getting back to the same location that you currently are. So the reality is that while we're talking, different emotions will come up, and I will explain why that is happening in a minute. But even if after we've finished talking, you do not feel happy with the conversation, you can always go back to the previous teachings that you've relied upon and continue to practice them. So you will end up exactly where you were when we began this conversation. So I don't feel
is
there's any...
Is this certain?
Yeah, that's certain as long as you practice the same techniques. Yes. And all of you are fairly comfortable with practicing those techniques now, are you not?
Well, no. Well, yes. Well,
you are able to do it. You know what to do. Let's
yes,
put it that
but...
way.
This is the issue that we have been facing for some time now, mm-hmm. is that many of us have heard you speak and observed certain things, and now there is a lot of discussion between us about whether what we have been doing is correct,
yep.
but also I suppose it is clear to say that we are afraid that by stopping these techniques we will plunge back to darkness,
mm-hmm.
and yet many of us now feel there is a flaw in the techniques.
Yes, so it's hard because you, on one hand you'd like to know more, but on the other hand you don't want to get plunged back into darkness and then have to go through the same process again.
Yes, and I find it difficult to even discuss this with you,
mm-hmm.
because it seems that...
Even during the discussion there's fear coming up and therefore your feeling of returning to darkness.
Yes.
Yep. Can we address that first? Can I ask you a few questions about do you believe in God at all?
We have discussed this also. Mm-hmm. No.
No?
And we understand, we have maintained... We are entertaining the idea.
Right. So you're entertaining the possibility, but at this point in time, you don't really believe that there is a God. Is that probably the best way to summarise it? And with regard to the progression that you've made thus far, you obviously have a level of discontent about it now. Is that not correct?
Well... We were happy with the progress that we had made,
mm-hmm.
but now we feel there is something stifling our growth.
Yes. Have you had during this time any brighter spirits come to visit you at any point? Ones that you are noticeably different to yourselves, but are much brighter and lighter?
On occasion, we see some brighter spirits.
Yeah.
However, they do not seem... related to us. We do not feel we can relate to them.
Yes, and can I explain why that is?
Yes.
Well, there are certain emotions that are in you that when you see these brighter spirits, those emotions are not in them. And so it's very, very hard for you then to feel some familiarity with them because you can see that those same feelings are not in them. And so therefore it's hard to feel a friendship. Does that make sense?
But also it is how they look.
Yes.
They look, for example, with my Tibetan friend,
mm-hmm.
he was brighter than I and those of us that he taught. But...
He still looks similar.
Yes.
In some ways.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. He seems real.
Yes.
And
whereas these
solid.
So these brighter spirits, if we or brighter people that you see occasionally... They seem a bit more... Transparent is probably not
like
the right word. But
no, like air, like light, like not just light and bright, but like their form is lighter and we are heavy.
Yep. Can I bring one of them to you, one of these brighter spirits? And I want to show firstly to you that these brighter spirits can change their condition back and forward. And if we, you know, discuss that, then we can start looking at why they can do that and so forth.
Okay, there, we are uncertain, but we...
Well, you know from experience that there is nothing you need to fear from these spirits. Isn't that not correct? Because they don't interfere with your life and they don't hurt you in any way when they come by.
No, but there is some fear that their proximity may also, just as our proximity towards yourself...
Mm-hmm.
makes us unsettled,
mm-hmm.
and almost as if we are losing condition.
Yeah.
There is some fear amongst us that the proximity of these ones will have the same effect.
Right. Would you like that I bring some to you, and perhaps we can then discuss this in more detail, remembering that you can always go back to our, you know, previous conversation where I mentioned that you can always use the same techniques as you've already used in the past.
Okay.
So if you always remind yourself of that you always have that fallback position, if you like.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Well, I'll ask some of my spirit friends to come and visit you. Now, these friends that I am asking to come and visit you, they have had a lot of fear when they were on the earth. But now they do not have much fear at all. In fact, if you look at them, can you see they're pretty much fearless, aren't they?
Yes.
And what do you notice about them? If you just relax a little and just let yourself describe what you see.
They seem friendly,
mm-hmm.
bright, relaxed in a way that... There is confusion because we believe that we were almost without fear.
Yes.
In the state that we had achieved.
Mm-hmm.
And this is why we were perplexed about our inability to progress.
Yeah.
But now it seems these ones are fearless in a way that we could only long for.
Yeah. Yeah. Can you see that you can't even feel any fear in them, can you? It's like, have you noticed that?
No, and it is
difficult.
And they seem
very relaxed, don't they?
Yes, yes.
Peaceful.
Yes.
And inner peaceful, isn't it, too?
Yes. Mm. It is difficult to believe that they have ever had fear in them, although they are showing us this.
So as they show you the pictures of their life on Earth, you can see that their life was quite stressful and quite
yes.
troubled.
Yes.
And if they just show you some pictures now of where they first arrived in the spirit world, can you see that it's, for many of them, it's actually worse than where you first arrived in the spirit
yes.
world? Yes. So they had a lot of fear in them, obviously. Yes. Now, the key for many of you at this point is you're starting to feel some, you know, some sadness and also some fear as they give you these pictures. The key is just to allow yourself to continue to let that flow inside of you. And just breathe as we have this discussion. Because what I would like to do is to help you through this process of understanding what's happened over the time that you've been in the spirit world and also what's happened to these particular people that are standing in front of you.
Can you tell us why we can't be rid of fear in this way? And
well, the answer to that question is very simple, actually. And if I can explain it to you in a bit of detail, I think you'll understand it pretty easily. Fear is an emotion, isn't it?
Yes.
Now, when you look at another person in the spirit world, can you see that when they have an emotion, there's a sort of energy flowing in their spirit body that you can actually observe? And there's also colours that come out of their body that relate to the emotion that they're experiencing. Have you noticed that?
No.
So what if I have one of the these spirits tell you a little funny story. Right. And then notice what colour is coming out of each of you as you laugh. So that's as an experiment. So
many colours.
Okay, what are those colours? Can you describe them?
Yellow, blue, pink, white.
Okay. Can you see these colours coming out? And a lot of them are quite bright, aren't they, when you laugh? You notice that?
We're not accustomed to communicating in this way.
Yes. We'll explain why they're communicating you in the way they are, but, you know, that's probably something for just a bit later in the conversation.
No, but we mean even in the colours.
Oh, okay. Yes. In what way are you concerned about this?
Well, we were taught to contain.
Yes.
To control, and because of this we can see now that this is part of what makes us solid.
Yes.
For these ones there is fluidity coming.
Well, there's these colours coming out of them all
yes.
the time, isn't
but
there?
We don't have colours. We don't like to let things come out of us.
Yes. So do you know why you don't like to do that? What happens when you start letting a colour come out? Have you ever noticed that? Because we can try and experiment with that.
We feel bad usually.
Okay, so in your desire to suppress specific emotions, can you see that all emotion starts getting suppressed?
Yes, but we thought this was the correct way.
Yeah, I understand. But you can see from these particular people that they don't really suppress their emotions, do they? Like you can see when they're happy.
No.
Yeah.
But now I feel frustrated.
Yeah.
I don't understand.
Yeah.
We are worried that to let go of this thing.
Yes, I understand. If I can explain in a bit more detail what's been going on for you. What happens is that you actually have a soul related to a spirit body, and you've probably heard me talk about that before.
Yes.
But you personally have not seen a soul, so it's hard to come to terms with believing that a soul exists. Is that not correct?
Yes.
However, if you notice that when you were laughing, your soul was engaged because you felt it to be a happy, like a joyful experience in that moment, and your soul was engaged in that moment. And so these different colours came out of you that don't normally come out of you or that you don't really notice coming out of you normally.
So do the colours come from the soul?
The colours come from your soul, yes. And the colours are a reflection of the soul's emotions and beliefs. So in other words, whatever you believe in the moment, whatever the moment is happening, is the colour that will come out. Now, if you're suppressing the soul's emotions or suppressing the soul's beliefs, then of course there's not much colour that can come out because you're actually controlling it.
We thought we were just controlling this body.
I know, but what I'm saying is you're actually attempting to control your soul,
right.
Which is another part of you. It's right. The part of you that has all of your memories and has all of your experiences. And, you know, some of you may be aware of what you call the Akashic record or the record of all of the events that have happened in your life. Well, your soul contains all of that as well. So all of this information is sitting in your soul, including all of your emotions and all of your belief systems and all of your desires and all of your passions and all of the things you long for and all of the intentions you have. That's all sitting within your soul. And your spirit body, which is the body that you currently see in each other, is a reflection of what that soul does. So in the moment that the soul laughs and there's a feeling of joy in the soul, these different colours come out of your spirit body reflecting those particular conditions.
Yes. We don't usually engage these kind of things.
Mm-hmm. I understand. You've noticed them, haven't you, though? In the past, sometimes you've noticed them.
But we were taught that these things were dangerous.
Yes, I understand.
Yes.
And what I'm suggesting to you is that the spirits that are in front of you, they don't seem to think those things are dangerous.
No. And this is our frustration.
Yep.
We feel we have we have grown since we passed over here. Many of us have come to terms with the fact that we have passed and we have grown.
Mm-hmm.
But since we came across you on the earth, we have observed many things and we have heard you speak of many things.
Mm-hmm.
But and it is appealing to become relaxed, to explore new possibilities and to be, I suppose, happy.
Yes.
However...
But when you attempt to engage the process, you become a bit darker and that's what you're concerned about.
Yes, and we didn't really consider that we weren't happy.
Yeah. Can you see the problem with suppressing emotion is that in the end you even suppress happy emotions and then you don't even know whether you're happy or not.
Mm.
And you...
We have aimed for peace.
Yes, I feel you've aimed for safety actually rather than peace. Because if you look at the people in front of you, they have peace, but it's not the peace you have.
No.
Can you see that?
Yes.
And they don't seem to be worried about their safety at all, do they? But no. It is a concern that you have. So obviously, there's. I think what you've been looking for mostly is safety or security, a feeling of certainty.
What is the difference between a safety and a peaceful feeling?
Well, true safety or true peace occurs no matter what environment you're in. So these particular spirits that are sitting in front of you, they could go to any environment they wanted to and they would still feel safe.
Mm.
Whereas if you went to an environment that was scary, you would probably then be afraid again. Have some of you tried to visit other places in the hills?
No.
No, because you feel afraid of going there. Can you see that?
Yes.
Whereas these spirits are not afraid of going there, are they?
No, but...
So can you see the difference between, like, safety and being afraid? They're two different things, really. And peace and safety are two different things.
So what's the difference between peace and feeling not afraid?
Well, the reality is for most people that if you create an environment that you feel safe, then most people in that environment would not feel afraid either.
And peaceful.
And they would feel peaceful. But if you put that same person in a place that they feel is unsafe, then straight away they wouldn't be peaceful anymore. Can you see that?
Yes.
Whereas these particular spirits that are in front of you, if you put them in a place... that they actually feel safe no matter what place they're placed in.
So peaceful.
They always have peace no matter where they go, whereas you only have peace when you're in a place that is perfect from your opinion. Do you understand the difference?
Yes.
So part of the problem that's happening in terms of when you start engaging your emotions through the process that I've described that you've heard many times before... Is that you begin to start having some feelings come up, and many of these feelings relate to sadness and fear. But the problem is you're so used to suppressing sadness and fear that immediately the energy in your spirit body, which is directed by the soul, starts depressing. It starts going dark, and then you get afraid even further, and so you don't engage the process even further. And what I'm suggesting to you is the reason why your feelings in your body, in your soul, result in your body going dark is because you're actually trying to suppress the feelings rather than feel them.
But haven't we done this successfully?
Well,
suppressed the feelings, this is how we learnt to grow.
Well, what you've learnt is a technique that many people on earth have taught for many thousands of years, really, which is a method of not responding to your own bad feelings. So what the spirit taught you was he said, yes, you have fear in you, but the way to progress forward is to act as though you have no fear in you, is to actually contain this fear, shut it down inside of you, and you learn this technique by finding the location of the fear in you.
Yes.
And then... sort of isolating that location.
Yes. Like shrinking it.
Yes, shrinking it. But can you see in your spirit body that where you've done that, there is a tear in your spirit body?
Mm.
Can you see that?
Mm.
So what's actually happening is every time you try to contain this emotion like this, there is a tear in your body. So it obviously is indicating that still something is not right there. Is that not the case?
Yes.
All right. Now, the alternative is to actually get rid of whatever is in the soul. And whatever is in the soul, in this case, it's an emotion of fear that exists within your soul. If you could release that from your soul somehow, then you wouldn't have to contain it anymore. It would be gone completely. And if you think about it, when you're on Earth, many of you have had accidents on Earth, or you've had a splinter or something like that when you're on Earth. You imagine if you had a splinter in your body, your physical body on Earth, and then what was the first thing you wanted to do with that splinter once it was in? Wasn't it to pull it back out again?
Yes.
Because while it was in, it just stayed there, didn't it? And bothered you and bothered you and bothered you until it came out, right?
Mm.
Well, if you think about this emotion as the same, it's like a splinter in your spirit body that is just sitting there, and it's festering, and you can see where the problem is in your spirit body, where you've tried to contain it. It's now worse than when you began. But the rest of your body seems okay, and so you've ignored the problem in that particular location.
Hmm.
Can you see that? And so what you're attempting to do is you're attempting to contain the problem. It's a bit like having a splinter in the body and trying to stop anything from bumping it, and that's the way you control it, you see?
Yes, we understand. We have heard you speak about release.
Yes.
Release of emotion. What? Yes, and we need to consider what you are saying. We feel, though, that it was effective to isolate the emotion. Yes, it is like a hole in our spirit body, but it seemed that the rest of our spirit body could improve after we contained it.
Yes.
Is this true?
This is true to a degree, and this is why it works for a little while, but after a while you remain stagnant. It will work to a degree, because what you're doing is you're isolating the energy of that pain into one location of your body.
Yes.
And what that does is it causes extreme damage to that one part of your body.
It is as if there is a hole.
Quite a big tear in the body itself in that particular location.
Yes.
But the rest of the body seems relatively unaffected by that. And the reason why that is happening is because you are containing the emotion, and the emotion reflects something that's happened in your life here on Earth in that particular location of the body, and that's why it has its centre there.
Yes, and this is part of our... Of course, as you have mentioned, we have not been dealing with our soul. So we had thought to progress, we must simply heal these specific areas that we had isolated.
Yes, but can you see you've had now quite a few years trying to heal that particular isolated area, but it's not healing?
No.
In fact, can you notice that it's probably, if you compare your memory of it to 10 years ago, can you see that it's actually probably a little worse in that particular area?
Yes, although we feel if we shrink it, the area is smaller. It may look worse, but it doesn't take as much of our spirit body. And so we see what you're saying.
Can you see that even though you've shrunk the area, you're concentrating lots and lots of your intellectual and mental energy shrinking this area, but the reality is the more you shrink it, the more intense it becomes in the area that's left?
Yes. But now we get to the main issues, the reasons we've been wanting to speak with you for some time. Because when we do this, we have a sense of strong mental power. We have a sense of strength and power that we can contain these things.
Mm-hmm.
When we have tried briefly to experiment with what you say, because we have heard you for some time, it is like these places expand. And
May I explain what happens there? You know how you've concentrated all of this energy of that particular emotion? In this case, it's fear-based emotion. But if you concentrate that in a certain area, then the more you concentrate something, the more intense it becomes in that particular area.
Yes.
Is that not true?
Yes.
Now, if you actually feel it and you no longer attempt to concentrate it, then what it does is it moves out of that area and through the rest of your body. So the energy is actually flowing again now through the rest of your body, yes?
This feels terrible.
I know that feels terrible, but if you go one step further and you allow it to completely flow, this is where you heal. And what's happening with when you're using your intellectual and mental energy to focus the attention and making the problem go away is you're actually concentrating the problem in a certain specific area, but the energy itself is still locked up in that particular area because emotion is energy in motion, and what you're trying to do is stop the energy from being in motion. And so what you're doing is you're focusing your attention to cause the energy to be in motion in a smaller area of your body. And then as you get more and more intellectual power, you do this even further, and you get more intellectual power and you do it even further. But it doesn't mean the actual problem doesn't exist still.
So you're saying, we want to be clear, you're saying we cannot progress in this way any further.
Well, you can only progress in this way by actually using more and more intellectual power and strength and therefore more control over your own emotions. Now, for many men, they can do that to a greater extent than women. For most women...
This was one of our questions.
For most women, it becomes more and more difficult because you start suppressing other emotions that you quite enjoy. And then as a result of that, you find it quite unsatisfactory earlier than men do. But many men and women do it very satisfactorily until they reach the sixth dimension of the spirit world. Do you know what dimension you are in the spirit world now?
We think we're in the second.
Yeah. And one of the reasons why you're in the second is because you've managed to control your fear to a certain extent.
Yes. Mm-hmm. We're not satisfied with
no.
where we are. And in fact, there is debate amongst us about where we actually are.
Well, how about we ask one of the bright spirits, because I think you'll find that they'll say something different about where you actually are.
They say no, that we're only in the first sphere.
Okay, so you're in...
But it's quite different to
yes,
when
it's very different from when you first arrived, because where you first arrived was what you would call the hells of the first sphere. And where you are now is in a brighter place that's very similar to Earth, but not better than Earth. And in some places it's not so good, but that's still in the first dimension or the first sphere. So you've managed over 60 years of your life now in the spirit world to progress through the first sphere to near the top of the first sphere, but it's going to be very difficult using the same techniques to go into the second sphere and beyond.
Yes, and now, now we feel irritated, mm-hmm. and this is the problem of speaking with you.
That I cause your irritation?
Immediately things begin to change,
mm-hmm.
and yes,
and it causes some distress.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what I'd like you to do is just for a moment just relax a little and breathe so that we can continue our conversation, because there's more things I can show you and there's much more that we can show you in a short period of time if you just allow yourself to engage the conversation.
Okay, yes, we have waited so long.
Yes, I agree.
We should hear.
Okay, so the reason why I asked you the question about whether you believed in God or not is because you can actually communicate with God through feelings. And most people are not aware of that when they first pass into the spirit world. And usually they're not aware of that for many centuries afterwards, after they've passed. And what I'd probably like to do is show you that first, if I may. But there has to be a willingness in you to experience some emotion when we do this. Right? And the emotion in particular is going to be the emotion of feeling overwhelmed by grief. Does that make sense? So I'm telling you in advance so that you're aware of what will happen through the process. Now, these bright spirits that are around us now, they're willing to help you go through this process if you're willing.
Why should we do the process?
Because you'll very rapidly find yourself in a much happier condition afterwards if you engage the process.
Can you tell us? Why can't you tell us?
Well, the problem with telling you about a process is it's like trying to tell you about an emotion. Unless you personally experience the emotion, it's very difficult to describe the emotion. So, for example, if you think back to times when you were loved or you felt love for somebody else on earth, it's very difficult to describe that emotion to another person, isn't it?
Yes.
Unless that person has actually felt the emotion themselves, it's very, very difficult for them to understand what the emotion feels like. And you can use all the words you like chatting away to a person about what love feels like, but unless they actually feel love, it's going to be very, very difficult for them to understand what you mean. Can you see that?
Yes.
And this is very much the same with any interaction we have in with God. It's very, very hard to describe an interaction with words unless you're willing to engage a process emotionally. So what I'd like to sort of experiment with here is a suggestion of an experiment that we can try. Now, if you like, just a number of you who feel a bit braver than others can try it first, and then we can help the rest go through that particular emotion too, if you like. So it's up to you whether you would like to all do it together or try it together, or whether you'd like to have some people try it and other people observe, or whatever you would like.
Yes, some people will do it. I'm not doing it
first.
Okay.
So what we want to do now is just sort you out a bit so that the people who are going to do this experiment go in one place and the people who are going to observe can observe them from another place.
Yes.
So is everything sorted out?
Yes.
Yep, good. Okay, well, those people who are willing to experiment, I would like to put forward just an experiment with God that you can try, and that is quite simple. It's this. Just say to yourself, if there is a God, and if you have some love for me, I would like to feel some of your love. Now, when I say to yourself, what I mean by that is, firstly, you can start saying it in your mind. If there is a God, and that God has love for me, I would like to feel some of your love. So you just say that in your mind.
Mm.
Now you notice if you say it in your mind, nothing really happens. Have you seen? Mm. Do you see
mm-hmm.
that?
Mm-hmm.
No one's experiencing anything different than they're normally experiencing?
No.
It's just a thought in their mind that they're saying? Okay. Now what I'd like you to try is another experiment. And this time, have a feeling that if there is a God and the God has some love for you to give to you, that you would like to feel it. But you're going to have to feel like you want to feel it. Do you understand?
Mm-hmm.
So just now just go allow yourself to go through the feeling of wanting some love from God if God exists and is willing to give you some. But you want it. You've got to want it from your heart now, not from your mind. Do you understand? Now, for some of you, that's going to be quite difficult, but for others, it would be a bit easier to try. So you start breathing. Let yourself breathe.
No, I can tell you.
Yeah. What do you observe?
Yes, one woman.
One woman really felt it with her heart, yes?
Yes.
And what's happening now?
Well, she's sort of a mess.
She's crying, yes. Sobbing?
Yes.
Yes, but notice what is happening to her body.
Yes.
What's happening to her body?
Yes, she looks better. She looks
brighter. But notice there's colours coming out of her body.
Yes.
What colours?
Many.
Many?
But no.
There's one dominant colour.
Yes.
What's that colour?
Coming out of her or into her?
Well, there's one colour, there's colours going into her and there's some going out of her at the same time, is there not?
Yes.
what are the ones coming out of her? I know the ones you want to describe, the ones going into her, yes? Because they're all colourful and bright and very light, yes? But I want you to look at the one coming out of her.
Yucky colour.
What's the colour?
Brown, browny, yucky colour.
Browny, grey.
Browny, green, yucky.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
But, yes, she looks better.
Can you see the colour that's coming out of her is the colour that matched her before, and the colour going into her is more like the colour that she now is?
Mm.
Can you see there must be something going on if yes. that's the case?
Yes.
All right. So what's going on is that she allowed herself to feel her feelings in that moment. And her feeling was she decided that she was going to try the experiment with her heart. Yes?
And yes, I'm very worried.
Why are you worried? She has benefited, has she not?
Yes, but the entire state seems so out of control.
It is, I agree.
And I have worked hard for that control.
Yes, I agree. So what you're worried about is that you've worked so hard for emotional control, but there's the lady letting go of this control, and she's got this very dark stuff coming out of her, but she's got this light stuff pouring into her at the same time. And she's changing, and she's looking a bit brighter. Yeah. And can you actually see that she could actually go and live now in a different place?
Hmm.
What place do those spirit friends say that she could go and live in now?
Yes, now in the second.
Okay. So can I recap the experiment for you? Just to give you some time to think about what's happened.
Mm.
So what's happened is we asked some of that group to have a feeling. Remember, first we asked them to have a thought and nothing happened. But we asked some of the group to have a feeling, and one lady there had a feeling that she wanted to receive God's love if God's love was available to her. And in that moment, she was left a crying mess on the floor, was she not?
Yes.
But she was willing to do that, wasn't she? And while she was willing to do that, that very bright, colourful light came into her. And at the same time, this very dark green, brown sludge came out of her.
Mm-mm.
Right. And if you look at the colour of that dark green brown sludge, that was more like the colour she was before.
So and many of us have these colours.
Yes, many of you have that colour. So this tells us some things, doesn't it? Can you see that?
Yes.
Yeah. And it also tells us that we only need to have a longing for God's love to enter us. And God's love can, but it has to be sincere. It has to come from the feeling. You notice the other ones who still tried to do it with their thoughts. And what happened?
Nothing
happened.
We are all, yes. We were worried that this would be what happens.
What are you worried about?
Well, we simply, we cannot imagine allowing this process. We've heard you speak or seen things happen. Mm-hmm. We've understood that this is perhaps what you mean.
We're referring to, yeah.
But this seems so unthinkable. Mm-hmm. And we were so hoping that there was another way.
So when you came to talk, you'd really like to have preferred me to say something else.
Yes.
Can I get you for a moment to ask those bright spirits who are still with you what process they had to follow?
Yes, we know.
Yes. So they had to follow this but same process.
There are others. There are others brighter than us who have done what we have done.
I agree.
We don't understand why.
Shall we ask some of them to come for a moment? Shall we?
Yes.
Can we ask your original Tibetan... Yes. Fellow, a friend to come. So how bright does he look in comparison to these really bright spirits that are in front of you?
He's not as bright.
Okay.
But he is brighter than me.
I agree. Now let's ask your Tibetan friend to turn up his brightness to his normal amount. Now, some of you may have to shield your eyes a little for that to happen.
Yes, it's very bright.
Okay, now let's ask some of the bright friends that have come to do the same thing. Can you even see them anymore?
It's like a lamp beside the sun.
Yeah. So one's as bright as the sun and the other one's like a lamp, like a light here on earth. So while your Tibetan friend has done work on himself to get himself into a brighter condition, can you see that what the other people have done has obviously been far more effective in terms of their long-term future?
Yes.
But they've had to engage the process that you've just seen in that, in the woman who did that process. That's what they've had to do. And that's a decision. Can you see that? That's a decision to give up this concept of control and to start allowing yourself to feel what you truly feel.
Yes.
But can you see in the process, the woman did not return back to her original condition that she arrived in the spirit world?
No.
See, that's what you were afraid of.
Yes.
But it didn't happen to her.
Why?
Well, because
when we tried,
yes,
it seemed like that was happening.
Well, when you tried, firstly, you tried to do it without any of God's love, firstly. Yes. That's number one. Secondly, you tried to do it while still suppressing your fear. So in other words, you tried, but it wasn't an emotional try, it was an intellectual try.
But even when we felt something.
Yes, but what you felt was the desire to live in the fear rather than to actually release it as an emotion. See, every time we have emotions in us. And every time we choose to live in them, which is what you have been worried about happening, if we choose to live in it, we will darken our condition. Our condition will, if you choose to do that, your condition will definitely go back. And when I say live in it, what I mean is to act in harmony with what the emotion dictates.
So even if we just were around you or speaking with you and suddenly we didn't act, we just suddenly
started feeling something,
yes,
that you wanted to suppress.
Yes,
can
we
you
did
see that?
Yes,
in every
yes
case you've wanted to suppress it.
Yes,
and when you suppress it, you will get into a darkened condition.
So even if we start to feel it, but we want to suppress it,
yes, you will become darker.
Okay.
Does that make sense? Because you're now acting in harmony with what the emotion dictates, rather than just allowing the emotion to flow inside of you.
Yes, this is helpful, thank you.
Yes.
Yes.
So what we need to do instead is what that lady did who was in front of you. She allowed the emotion to flow in her while she received love from God. Do you see that?
Yes, we see now from what you're saying the two differences.
Yep.
That we didn't, many of us are still undecided about God. But also the flow.
But do you notice the woman was undecided about God when we began this process?
Yes.
But she had a sincere desire to give it a try.
Yes.
That's all she had to have, just a sincere desire to give it a try. She didn't even have to know whether God existed. She didn't have to know for certain what the outcome would be. She just had to emotionally give it a try. But it had to be emotional. It couldn't be intellectual. It couldn't be something that she thought from her mind. It had to be something she engaged with her heart.
Yes.
And when she did that, the emotion came out of her at the same time as this other emotion started entering her. And the reason why that happened is she had an openness to feel the fear-based emotion while she was open towards love. You see, when we open to one emotion, we automatically start opening to other emotions. When we close to one emotion, we automatically start closing to other emotions.
Mm.
And this is something that you haven't realized. When you start closing down the emotions of fear and don't experience them, you also start closing down the emotions of joy and happiness and those emotions, they all start, and love starts getting closed down as well. You see, the reason why is because we're not able to selectively control emotion as well as what you think. And in fact, no one in the spirit world has successfully selectively controlled emotion.
So the choice is emotionless
versus emotion full of emotion.
Yes.
Yes. And releasing the emotions that are out of harmony with love by letting yourself experience them. Just like that lady did right in front of you. She had a big cry, yes? Big cry, still crying, yes?
Mm-hmm.
But because she's allowing the process, that every time she longs for a bit more of God's love, you see that bright colour goes into her and she's going brighter, brighter, brighter. She's not relegating back to the dark condition. And this gooey muck, the brown, greeny, gooey muck that's in her is coming out of her. And you notice the area where it was in her body that she was controlling before? You can see that it's like a healing sore.
Mm.
It's actually healing, just like a sore on a physical body would heal.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So all that's required really is for each of you now to have a feeling about that, about, well, let's look at it logically. This is what's happened. So obviously something's going on there that's caused a rapid change. And this lady before, she was having the same trouble as all of you in that she thought she had released fear, and she also thought she was a bit more progress, did she not? And she also believed that everything was going good, but she was also feeling stagnant. And look at her now. She's not stagnant now. She's growing and she's changing. The colours in her are changing. You can see that the dark stuff that was in her is releasing from her. Yeah. You can even feel the emotion that's coming out, yes? You can feel what it's about?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
So she's releasing that experience from her childhood in the time that she was there, in her first incarnation on Earth. And can you see she's actually releasing it? It's actually leaving her. So the experience, the actual emotional experience of that memory is releasing from her.
Yes, yes, we have heard you speak of this many times, but this is the first experience to witness it. And
because you can see from many of the discussions that I have with people on Earth, while many of them believe they understand the process, many of them don't experience it because otherwise you'd be observing exactly the same happening with their spirit body.
Yes.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
So this is why it's also been difficult for you to accept, because many of the people who think they're trying to do it are not actually doing it.
Mm. I've not witnessed this before.
Yeah. But if you look at what this lady has done, she's obviously tried it in a pure way, in a desire, with pure desire, and it's had an immediate benefit to her.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Does that help, Tiffany, in terms of what's happening?
Like, yes, yeah? And really, we must thank you. And forgive me because I do not feel completely grateful at this point.
That's okay. You will be at some point in the future, I believe.
Yes.
I know what it's like because you hear some information and then you go, oh, but this means that I've got a lot of work to do, and it's work that I don't really know whether I want to do. And I understand, you know, that's the feeling that's present.
And truly we feel, most of us now understand, we had some understanding of the concepts you were discussing before our talk here this evening. But we had hoped there may be a different way.
Yes.
Or, what we would consider a more effective way. But
yes.
Clearly this has shown us that this is not the case.
No. Can you see too, if we look at your Tibetan friend, he even is concerned about the different way now. Mm. Can you see that?
Mm.
So he's now even questioning whether the way that he's been thought all of his life and all of his life on earth was actually the right way.
Mm.
And this is very good to question, because if there is a more effective way that is going to happen much more rapidly, then it would make sense to embrace it, even if it's painful.
Yes, we see that, but it does remain a decision. It seems clear now what you have demonstrated.
Mm-hmm.
However, what remains is to decide if we will do this.
Yes. And can I suggest to you that you actually have nothing to fear doing it other than pain?
Mm.
Can you see that lady in front of you was willing to feel her pain, and she's benefited from it?
For many of us, the feeling of fear seems more horrible than that of pain.
I understand, but all of your fear is associated with pain. Can I demonstrate the relationship?
Yes.
You see, painful things occurred in your life on earth. Is that not true?
Yes.
But every one of those painful things now has a fear associated with it that it might happen again.
But for myself, it seemed I was afraid even before anything happened.
Well, this is because when we first incarnate onto the earth, we start absorbing our parents' emotions. So if you can remember your mother in particular, what did you notice about her? Can you see how much fear she had?
Yes, I see that now,
logically. Yes. And so a lot of your fear is actually not things that have happened to you, but actually things that have happened to your mother that you now believe might happen to you because you absorb the same emotion from her.
Mm.
Does that make sense?
Mm.
And in fact, you then acted upon your fear, if you think about it, on earth, and sometimes that did create negative events, didn't it? You think about when you acted upon your fear.
Yes.
A lot of times what you were afraid of happening did finish up happening, did it not?
Yes.
Yeah. And yes. This created more fear.
Yeah. Yes.
Yep. And because you didn't understand the relationship, that the fear inside of you, which came from your own mother, attracted events in order for you to release the fear by experiencing it, you chose to suppress it. And then as you suppressed it, it attracted a stronger event.
Mm.
And it continued to attract stronger events until you passed.
Yes. And this is what actually led us to listen to you.
Mm.
Because I learned when I passed that it was my fear that had attracted more fearful events to me.
Yeah.
But I had thought that the way to deal with this was to control my fear.
Yes.
So when you spoke of fear attracting fear, I was interested in what you said.
Mm-hmm.
But of course you have now explained something different.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. And
one other thing too that I'd like you to bear in mind from this conversation, and that is this. The lady who tried to connect to God by going, if God exists, and if God has some love for me, can I please receive some of that love? And she had a feeling in her that she wanted to do that, a feeling of wanting to receive. You remember that?
Yes.
Doesn't that in a way prove that God must exist?
Yes.
And also that God has love to give us. And it also proves that when God gives us that love, if we're open to receiving it, we will change. And we will change and become better, not worse. So it proves those three things. Can you see that?
Yes, I see your point.
Yeah. Now, if God does exist, then surely that God wants us to be happy. And surely if it's that simple, if it's just as simple as just being completely open emotionally and letting these bad emotions flow out and letting the good one flow in, surely that would make sense to engage that process.
You mistake me for someone who would find that simple.
I didn't say it was an easy, I said it was simple. It was simple to understand, isn't it?
Yes. Again, forgive me, because I can feel the... this is not an easy conversation.
I understand. The reason why you feel so afraid is because you're afraid of pain, and you're also afraid of being a mess on the floor, and you're also afraid of how that will look to other people.
Yes.
And you're also afraid of how it will look even to yourself.
Yes.
You're also afraid that, and already I've listed four or five fears that you said you never had.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And I could keep on going, but you get the picture of obviously there's quite a number of fears there that are preventing you from making what appears to be a relatively logical choice.
Yes, and this is... We see the logic, yes.
Yeah, so the question becomes, are you going to continue to act in your fear or are you going to make the logical choice?
Yes.
That, can you see that's
and
really
this
the decision?
Is, yes, this is what we feel. It is only left as a decision.
Yes. That you need to engage with your heart, not with your head.
Yes, and we do feel so accustomed to the head.
Mm. So that's what you're comfortable with.
Yes. Yeah.
But can you look back even onto your life on earth? Can you see how when you were on earth, you often engaged your emotions in a feeling way and you weren't afraid of them then?
Well, this is the point. We felt, many of us, that the development we gained since passing was because we learned to develop our intellect and we had neglected this while on earth.
Mm. When the reality is that what you did on earth allowed you to experience different emotions, but the emotion of fear was present.
In every case, yes.
Right? And it's the emotion of fear that you're terrified to feel.
Yes.
And yet it's just an emotion, because the lady in front of you has demonstrated that it's just an emotion.
Yes.
You see, and at this point in time, you still intellectually and emotionally feel it's not just an emotion. You feel it's the end of your world.
Yes.
But the reality is it's just an emotion.
Yes, and we will need to experiment.
Yes, but make sure you experiment with your heart, you know, because any experiment you conduct with your mind, as we've just demonstrated, is going to be quite ineffectual.
Yes.
If you don't engage with your heart, the experiment, then of course you're not going to get any result. And you can see this in the people I've been speaking with on earth many times. They don't engage the experiment with their heart. Can you see that? And so there is no result or very little result.
Mm.
When they engage, you've seen and observed some people who have engaged the experiment with their heart. And what do you notice?
Yes, this happens in moments or minutes and it is extraordinary.
Yes.
Mm.
Yeah. And there's a big transformation in them, isn't there? And there's a big change in their body that you observe.
Mm. Mm.
They don't observe it because they're on earth and they can't see it, but you observe it.
And not all of them maintain this change.
That's because many of them choose to still act in harmony with their addictions and so therefore they revert in their condition. On earth, it's very easy to revert in your condition because you're still engaging life and sometimes you take unloving actions and that causes a degradation of your soul.
Mm.
And sometimes you take loving actions and that causes an improvement in the soul. And you can see the relationship if you look at them. You can see when they've taken that unloving action, that's when there's been a degradation in their soul. When they've taken a loving action, that's when there's been an improvement in their soul. And when they release their emotion that's holding them back, there's an improvement in their soul, but many improve in their soul and then go and take an unloving action. And then, of course, that degrades their soul.
And this clarifies some of the questions that we had because we were questioning the efficacy of this process if we observe many... in a to-ing and fro-ing of condition.
Exactly.
We clearly want to move permanently.
Permanently forward, yes. Now, these people on earth could move permanently forward too if they chose to act in a more ethical manner and live in harmony with the loving choice.
Mm.
But unfortunately, but what I'm illustrating to yourself is there is a direct correlation between the unloving choice and the degradation of the soul.
Mm.
And there is a direct, and when they choose to make a loving choice, including the choice to feel their emotion appropriately, there is an improvement in their soul. And this is what you can remember. If we continue to make to release the emotions that are negative, there will be an improvement in our soul so long as we don't make further choices that are unloving.
Yes.
And that's all you need to remember with regard to these things that you look at.
Yes. Thank you. This is clear now. This has clarified many questions that many of us have carried for some time.
Yeah.
And it has been difficult, although it is unclear why, as to why we couldn't finally have this understanding by just listening to what you speak to others about.
Well, this is the overrated thing about listening, if I could say, in that we can listen to the words and think we understand, but unless we're willing to engage a process with our heart, no change will actually be made.
Mm.
And this is a very important lesson to understand for your future, because what happens with most people is they listen, but because they still have doubts and they're not willing to try the experiment, you know, they're not willing to make a mistake and they're afraid of making mistakes. And so what they do is they don't try the experiment. And when you don't try the experiment with your heart, of course there will be nothing that you can measure. And therefore, nothing you can believe.
And so the engagement, because we thought we had experimented with what you teach,
mm-hmm.
and yet from our discussion, it is clear that we were resisting, we were reacting and resisting
mm-hmm.
to the process.
And also, if you think about it, you're very much resisting this idea or concept that God exists and God has love to give you. And as long as you are open emotionally to the reception of that love, that you can receive it.
Mm.
You're very resistive to that particular concept.
Yes, and it is clear that emotional work is required surrounding this issue, an engagement, as you have explained.
Yes. Now, there are reasons why many of you have not desired. If you look at the lady, if I can just go back, if you look at the lady who did make the choice to, if there is a God, could you please love me, and had that feeling for God.
Sandra, her name is Sandra. Sandra.
Well, if you look at Sandra, can you see back through her belief systems, can you see on earth there was a time when she actually did believe in God?
Yes.
And that's probably one of the major differences, isn't it, between her and many of the others that have engaged that process, in that they don't really believe there's a God, whereas she's had some concept that a God perhaps does exist. Can you see?
Yes, we see. There are many of us who attended churches.
Of course, but not many of you who got touched by your heart by the concept of God.
No. No, this is true.
Yeah. And if you allow this concept of God to touch your heart now, then you may develop within you a desire to connect to that God.
Certainly amongst us now there is a feeling, I suppose you would call it, that this seems challenging but also possibly beautiful.
Yeah. Yeah, I feel it's very beautiful, but also you have the potential to change very rapidly if you embrace this process.
Thank you.
It's my pleasure. Can I just have one more moment of your time, though? The bright spirits who came to us the first time, the reason why I asked those particular spirits to come to you is because they have had this personal experience that you need to go through now, which is this personal experience of making a choice to actually feel the emotions with a sincere heart. And they were very, very afraid of doing that when they began, some of them.
Mm-hmm.
And so they have the personal experience of understanding what it feels like for you to make that choice. So what I'd recommend that you do now is have a conversation with them about what caused them to actually go ahead and make that choice, rather than just keep resisting that choice all the time like you've been doing over your life.
Okay.
Yeah?
Yes, we can do this. This feels doable.
Yeah. And I feel if you engage them in that conversation, they'll be able to explain to you what, you know, the different reasoning they had as to why they eventually made that choice. And some of those reasonings will definitely assist you to make the same choice. But But make sure when you do it that you truly choose it with your heart, and rather than just believing that you're choosing it with your mind and then seeing no result.
Yes, thank you.
It's a pleasure.
I feel some hope.
Yeah.
Just now when you describe speaking with them, this is something surely that I can do, and yes, yeah. I feel encouraged.
And they will help you look at your fears in a more truthful manner. So, you know, some of the fears that you have about feeling your emotions and being a mess on the floor and crying, and some of the judgments that you have about your particular emotions, and these, they'll help you come to understand that these judgments and have come from your earth-based experience, and they don't need to be continually accepted. So they'll help you look at those particular judgments that you have about emotion, and look at the different fears you have about emotion, and help you work through those. Because unless those particular fears are addressed, then you won't sincerely engage this process with your heart. Yeah.
Thank you.
It's my pleasure, Tiffany. Yeah. It's getting a bit cold in here. Yeah, can we ask for the guys to maybe either off the air conditioner or make it a bit warmer? Yeah. So how did you find that as a... any of you like to have any questions about that? If we can bring microphone over to here. Sorry if you can grab that one there. Oh, this one's coming, so that's good. Can you hold the microphone?
Oh, sure.
And
okay.
Robin, can you watch the camera that you're right in front of? Thank you. Sorry about that.
Hello. When you were
you hold it right up close.
When you were okay. Yeah. When you were talking about the problem in the spirit body that was coming from her unresolved emotion.
Yeah.
So my question is, when we have in the physical body, when we're still on Earth, alive in a human physical body, if we have a problem in a certain area of our body, does that originate first in the spirit body from an emotional origin? And then by the time we feel it in the physical body, it's kind of like all the way down at the bottom, and we have to work ourselves back up to heal it? I mean, how does that interconnect?
Well, the problem exists in your soul. Your soul is what, you know, stores all and also is able to transmit all emotion. So the problem firstly exists in your soul. Then when you suppress it or deny it, the soul's energy system cannot work correctly. And so what it does is the energy stops flowing in a certain area of your soul. That then automatically affects your spirit body. So your spirit body then starts demonstrating exactly the same problem with itself in a certain location. Mm-hmm. Because the energy in that particular location has stopped flowing. And then over a period of time, if we continue to deny the emotion and continue to suppress the emotion, then eventually the same location in your physical body will start having problems. So when you think about it, any physical illness or sickness is already the result of a long stream of denial that's occurred from the soul's emotion not flowing, the spirit body's energy no longer flowing because of the emotion not flowing, and then the physical not flowing either. It causes then a physical illness. So whenever a physical illness comes out in your physical body, you must firstly go, okay, I'm already in a lot of denial. I've shut down already a number of things. I've shut down my soul, and I've also shut down the experience of the emotion that's causing this problem, but I've also shut down the energy systems that are reflecting that in my spirit body as well. And so by the time you get a physical problem, you've already got a lot of denial of emotion. And this is a very important thing to remember if you want to heal your body, because the physical problem is demonstrating a lot about the emotional condition.
So the spirit body and the physical body essentially look alike in terms of their wounds.
Well, for many of you, your spirit body looks much worse than your physical body. Actually.
Because it hasn't manifested on the physical yet?
That's correct. So the reason why we grow old, for example, is that our spirit body is already in a degraded condition, and our physical body, over the replication process of its cells, slowly approaches the condition of our spirit body. So the fact is that almost everybody on this planet gets old and wrinkly, and by the time they're 70 or 80 years of age or 100 years of age, usually by the most, they die. And that's an indication of what the spirit body looks like at the time of death. So at the time of death, the spirit body looks very similar to the physical body and that's been aged. Does that make sense?
Yes.
And it also looks very similar to the physical body's ailments that it has at the time of death. Mm-hmm. In fact, it's why death occurs. Mm-hmm. The reason why death occurs is because the physical body can no longer maintain an energetic connection with the spirit body due to the illnesses that are present, the emotional problems that are present in the soul. And as a result of that, death in the physical body occurs.
Mm-hmm. Okay, just one last question.
Sure.
So if I were working on someone and I could see their spirit body and giving them that feedback and then also working with them emotionally about what's happening in the soul, that would be the way to go about helping them.
Healing them, yes. And the problem is that many people, including many of the people who are healers, don't want to see anybody's spirit body because they see... They're very frightened of seeing the true condition of the spirit body. Mm-hmm. And for that reason, many healers want to falsify the condition of the spirit body and tell the person who's come along to be healed, like, you know, that's much better than it really is. And oftentimes also, they prefer to see the spirits that are with the person rather than the person's own spirit body as well. So... this often causes an inaccurate reflection to the person who has come along to be healed, and as a result of that, they start to have an opinion which is an overinflated opinion of their own condition, and therefore they don't feel any need to change, and that's a big part of the problem with regard to healing. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. That's very helpful.
So does everyone understand the relationship between the soul's emotions that are shut down and the spirit body starting to have energetic problems where the flow of energy in the spirit body is shut down and therefore a physical thing begins appearing over a period of time? And even the fact that we get old aged and, skin loses its elasticity and eventually we get wrinkles and all these other things happen, they're all a part of what is going on, telling us that our spirit body has actually got a problem and therefore our soul has suppressed emotion that we need to address. Yeah? If we go at the back there, if you just leave your hand up when I point so that Robin can... Thank you, Robin.
So are you saying that the healthier the person is, the better their soul condition is?
No, I'm saying if a person approaches their true soul condition, the older they get.
Okay.
So if a person was 100 and they look 25, then that would tell me that they have a very good soul condition. Does that make sense?
But if they're
25 and they look 25, that doesn't mean much at all.
Well, if you have a 25-year-old with a lot of health problems,
yes,
and then a 25-year-old that was totally healthy... with no problems, would you assume certain things about that person?
Well, firstly, I would never assume anything about anybody. I'd want to know the truth about anything before I did anything. But usually the person who has a lot of physical illnesses by the time they're 25 years of age has had a lot of specific emotional problems from their parents that they've had probably the majority of their lives. And so that tells me that their growing up environment was probably not very good in terms of the emotional condition of their parents. Does that make sense?
Definitely.
And that's had a big bearing on, therefore, their own physical body and what their physical and spirit body could manage because of the suppression of their soul. A person who looks quite good at 25 and has seemingly no problems at 25... probably has less of those particular problems that are referred from their parents. However, unfortunately, many of them are acting in a very unloving way towards themselves and a very unloving way towards their own body and their own life, and also in an unloving manner towards others. and they haven't learnt how to give love yet, many times by the time they're 25. And as a result of that, their spirit body often looks much worse than they believe. However, it's probably not as bad, the spirit body is not as bad as a result of their parents, but rather of their own choices and conditions. And there is a very different reflection of those two things. You see, the spirit body or the soul that's been impacted upon by parents usually has a very poor start in life and therefore has a very a lot of trouble with sickness in its early stages of life. And that is primarily the result of the parents' suppression of emotion rather than their own. And in fact, I have seen many children have worse physical problems than their own parents have. However, the spirit body of the parent is in a terrible condition. Right? Mm. And often the parent blames the child for its poorer physical condition, when it's actually the parent's suppressed emotion that's caused the child's poorer condition. So you cannot make judgments about what the person looks like.
I didn't mean judgments. I meant that, can we see God's laws at work there?
There are always God's laws at work, obviously, but we need to understand that many people who have many sicknesses by the time they're in their 20s have obviously had a large degree of suppression from their parents rather than necessarily making choices about their own life.
So if you had two people who were 50 who were both healthy at 25, one at 50 was really sick and had cancer and da-da-da, and another one was totally healthy, no medications, what could you then say about those two people?
Well, obviously the one who's got cancer is suppressing a certain type of emotion so much that it's now caused a physical eating away of his own physical body. And that tells me that this particular type of emotion is causing them problems. However, we can't make a judgment about their whole condition, can we? It's only the particular emotion that's causing the particular problem. And this is the problem with making judgments, is that, or making assessments based on an illness, is that specific problems cause specific problems with our body. Now, some of us have those specific problems only, but have them to a large degree. Other people have no specific problem, but have a general problem right across, and therefore no specific problem to a large degree, which means there's no specific illness. However, by the time they're 50, if they look very similar, then there's an indication that obviously the general condition of their soul is still probably quite similar.
Thank you. That helps a lot. Mm. Thanks.
Yep.
Can I just ask you to clarify something else? Because there's also something that happens, isn't there, when we project a lot of our emotion outwards,
yes,
rather than when we absorb a lot of emotion from our environment.
Yes.
That actually has an impact on our physical health as well, doesn't it?
And our soul. Like if you project all of your emotion outwards, then it will have a terrible effect on somebody else's soul and possibly on their bodies if they absorb that particular emotion. But it will also have a shocking effect on your own soul. Right. However, because you're not absorbing the emotion from others in that state, you often look better than they do from a physical perspective, but because you're not absorbing any of their demands or any of their desires. Or does that make sense? And so therefore you're living with exactly what you want to do with your life while you're damaging people around you. Often people like that physically look fine and have very little physical problems with their own body, but finish up having huge problems with their spirit body and having huge problems after their death. So you cannot compare what's happening to the physical body and then make certain judgments or assessments about the soul as a result. Yeah. You have to be able to see the spirit body before you could make such assessments. You also need to bear in mind that the physical body has a delayed reaction to the soul's condition. Because the physical body, most of the cells in the physical body replicate, some of them replicate within a few minutes, but many cells in the body only replicate once every 7 years. Because of this replication process having across a 7-year period, it can often take years before a certain problem shows itself in your physical body.
And just one more point on that, because we spoke about this recently as well with someone in private, was about how often when we start, when we first hear divine truth, we're in perfect health, and then within a month there's physical ailments manifesting themselves everywhere in our physical body. Mm. Can you tell us why that happens?
Or? Well, you can, so you, so you may as well do that.
Yeah, well, I think you'll do it in a more articulate way. But
I don't think so.
So often that happens, or the way I feel about it, is because we're beginning to engage a process with God that He is allowing us to put up. We haven't involved our will before then. He's just got the law of compensation working on our soul the whole time, but His mercy is such that while we're on earth, we can decide whether we want to really know our own soul condition or not. Once we decide to engage that process with our will, then He goes, okay, here you go. Here's a few things to look at. And you know
here's
that
a knowledge
from,
of your condition.
Yeah. You know that from not only your physical body, but your whole life starts to change immediately, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
And that's actually a loving provision based on your desire. So when you have a desire to know what's wrong with your spirit body and really a desire to know what's wrong with the soul, then you'll start receiving messages in your body based on that desire. If you have no desire to know, then you're suppressing it. And when you suppress it, it's like localizing. It's what that spirit did, localize the problem and try to shrink the problem. That's what you're doing when you suppress your emotion. You're localizing the problem, so you're causing a bigger problem in that particular area that eventually will demonstrate itself in your body. Yeah. And it might take 7 years to demonstrate itself in your body. But when you're desirous of knowing, now you're not localizing the problem anymore and you're going to feel the problem much more strongly. And as a result of that, be able to recognize quite instantly, in many cases, what the cause is. And this is a beautiful way of God helping you through the process of understanding what's going on with yourself.
Mm.
Yep. If we come down two rows. Yep.
To Marina?
No, just above.
Yep. Actually, just...
just behind.
If you go just behind you first, Marina.
Behind first.
The lady, yep.
Hi, AJ.
G'day. Hold it a bit closer to you.
Okay.
That's it.
I hear myself, yeah. One of the YouTubes I watched, you had talked about having problems on the left side of your body related to injury from your mother. And I was wondering, is there specific things like I had, like if it's on the right side, is it your father?
Yes.
Oh, my goodness. I thought, last year I had my gallbladder removed. I was having awful pain, you know, down there. And
on the right side.
When I was watching YouTube, I thought it came up to me that, I wonder if that's like stuff with my dad.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
And you know what's with your dad.
Yeah.
That's unhealed yet. You've wanted to believe it's healed, but it's not healed yet.
Okay.
And there you go. That's very good. That's very good. You know it's not healed. And the key is to allow yourself to feel what's not healed and allow yourself to go through the emotional experience of it. Yeah. In that, if you keep shutting it down, then physical problems will always be the result. And yes, a very good indication, left side, feminine, right side, masculine. Left side of your body is going to be about issues you have with the feminine. Right side of your body is going to be issues you have with the masculine. Yep. And and you can certainly find a lot about those particular things as you go through things.
Yeah, I think and another video I watched, and part of it has to do with the fear of the anger not being holy.
Yes, a lot of people have that problem.
Feeling like I should be loving and forgiving, you know, to my father. And so I release so much and then I think, okay, that's enough. Now I need to be loving and forgiving.
Yes, mm. Yeah.
So
true forgiveness will result when you've released all the emotions with your dad. Once you've released all the emotions with your dad, you'll actually feel a sense of peace about your dad. And even if your dad continued in his same behavior, you would not have all this anger and resentment about his behavior come up every time he acted a certain way.
Well, he passed in 94. So
it's immaterial to me whether he's passed or not, because he's still alive. And oh, it's right. The same. It's exactly the
same. I meant as far as his acting out, like in.
Yeah, the reality is that there's still emotions going on there with your dad, and your dad can feel those emotions, and of course he's created many of them. He's treated you quite badly at times, mm-hmm. and he needs to go through his particular problems and issues with that. But your body is telling you who the problem is with.
Okay.
Does that make sense? So yeah. From the left side is your mum, the right side is your dad. Left side, it could also be about yourself because you're a female.
Right.
The right side is always going to be about something on the male side. And this applies to any problem. You might be cutting yourself a lot on the left-hand side, or all sorts of things can be happening to your body. Injuries that you have, they all tell you things about whether the problem you have got is with the feminine or with the masculine.
Oh, okay. Yep. Thank you.
Pleasure. Marina, if we come straight in front of you.
I didn't mind that she went before me. Okay. If you are a person...
Marina, it was too bad if you minded. Sorry.
I didn't understand what you said.
It was too bad if you did mind anyway.
Oh, okay.
Because she was going to go before you. Fire away.
Well, that didn't feel very nice. Okay. All right. If you are a person or a spirit who has passed and you have a lot of knowledge about God and you now or recently understand that you have never connected to it emotionally, but you would like to experiment it in the same manner as which Mary had channeled earlier.
Yep.
Is there something else that someone can do to be able to connect with God and grow this as more of a feeling as opposed to an intellectual understanding?
Well, it's a good question, because many Christians who pass and many people on the planet who have a feeling that God, a thought that God exists, only do a lot of their stuff with regard to God because of family-based issues or society-based issues. And many of them don't have a real connection with God that comes from their heart. And so what I would suggest to those people is that they first need to look at the reasons why they have heard about God all of their life, but still don't really have a feeling that God exists or not. And a lot of the times, the reasons for such things are to do with anger and rage about God, or anger and rage about what their parents have dumped on them about God. And that has caused them to have a feeling of disconnection from God, even though they've listened about God all the time. So we need to get very sincere with our emotions. So if we allow ourselves to feel about what we actually feel about God, rather than telling ourselves that we believe in God when our emotions are not engaged with that belief, then we'd be far better off in the process of experimenting with our relationship with God. So that's what I would recommend, that people start looking at their anger and rage and fear associated with God, rather than first try to manufacture a feeling of love for God when those feelings, anger, rage and fear, exist within them about God. Many of us who have been brought up religiously have huge fears about God, because we've been taught that God's going to punish us if we do something wrong, that God's going to, you know, browbeat us into submission. Many of us have been taught that we're here on earth even for a test. It's just one great big long test that God's putting us through. Much of the test which we're failing, we feel. Or we feel that it's not fair that God has done this test of us. And all of these beliefs are incorrect, but they are beliefs that enter us from our religious history, and we need to allow ourselves to feel about them, because without feeling about them, it's highly unlikely that we'll actually end up having a feeling of longing for God's love, which is the transformational part of the progress. So we need to address those particular emotions. So the spirits who have had a history with religion but still do not have a feeling need to examine the reason why they don't have a feeling. And in most cases, they will find that they've only had a history religion because of the environmental pressure, or because of their fear that God might exist and will eventually punish them one day if they don't believe. And these kind of belief systems suppress their feelings for God as a result.
there's a lot of feeling around church and the church views and yep. A lot of priest stuff. And it's like you know about God, so immediately your soul resonates because we have that innate understanding. But all of the programming that you have up until a certain point kind of denotes that.
Yes.
And anger and fear and God feel like two separate entities unless it has to do with punishment.
Yeah.
But there's like this real thing about, I noticed for myself in visiting the hells in my sleep state and communicating with some people about this.
Yeah.
And there's no God and there's nothing. And it's like, we used to believe in God, but not anymore.
Yes.
And I don't know how to show them that. It reflects my condition, of course, but I'd like to be able to.
Can I illustrate why many arrive in the spirit world when they believe to be the God in God on earth, but they arrive in the spirit world in a dark condition, and then they no longer believe in God? Can I talk about why that's the case? The primary reason why that is the case is there are people on earth who believe in God, but they use God as a justification for evil deeds and evil desires. Mm. So in other words, many times, so if you look through the Dark Ages, for example, and look at what the Catholic Church did with with the Spanish Inquisition, just as an example. So there you have a church that states a belief in God, and who's willing to enforce this belief in God on people, so much so that it's willing to murder many millions of people to force its belief. Now, the people who were engaged in doing that were willing to murder other of God's children. Now, in the process of murdering, their own soul condition becomes darker every single time. Dark, dark. Just even murdering one person, your soul becomes very dark. Imagine if you're murdering like thousands or hundreds of thousands or torturing to death and murdering millions of people as an organized process, then of course it's a very, very dark condition of the soul. As a result of that, they arrive in the spirit world in the depths of the hells when they believed that they should arrive in heaven and be on Jesus' right hand, you know, like, and so many of them instantly, as a result of that, no longer believe in God, that a God exists. Because they have this self-righteous feeling that they did all of that for God's sake. Mm-hmm. Right? Not understanding that true development is only about love. It's not about any religious philosophy that you may embrace and then push onto other people. It's about how much love you have for other people and how much love you demonstrate to other people. Now, if I demonstrate love for other people in an active way while I'm on earth, I will always arrive in the spirit world in a good condition. If I demonstrate a lot of hatred and other resentful type of emotions towards groups of people or other people on earth, I will always arrive in a bad condition in the spirit world, whether I had a belief in God or not. It's immaterial whether I had a belief in God or not as to what condition I will arrive in if I've embraced an unloving course of action while I'm on earth. So for that reason, there are many atheists who pass into a much better condition than many Christians, because those atheists are not condemning or attacking or actually using religion as a justification for violent acts. And so they arrive in a stronger condition of love, and therefore often arrive in a better condition than many spirits who believed in God while they were on earth. So that's very interesting, isn't it? You can have a belief that just touches your mind, but if love doesn't touch your heart in some point, it makes no difference. God's laws all operate upon love, not upon belief. And in a way, that's reassuring, isn't it? Don't you think? That all of God's laws operate on love and not belief? Because it really, it doesn't matter if haven't discovered the right beliefs yet. What matters is, have you discovered how to love yet? That's what matters.
That's very hard if you have never been shown love.
I can't agree with that, Marina. It gets said to me over and over again, and I cannot agree, because there is this underlying principle that I taught in the first century, which is an underlying principle I believe most people on earth want to forget, and that is this. Mm-hmm. if I do to you what I would like you to do to me, I will have a very good concept of love. But if I'm willing to do to you things that I would not be willing to accept you doing to me, then I have a very distorted concept of love. And the majority of people on this planet are not willing to look at what they do to other people. And therefore, they have a very distorted look at love. And they don't ask themselves that one simple question. Would I be happy doing what I do to somebody else if it was being done to me? And when we ask that question, then we understand love a lot better. And that's what I would call ethics. Most of us on Earth have no ethics, right? We believe we should get away with what we do not allow another person to get away with, right? Now, if we had a true state of understanding of love of any type, we would at least know that particular one truth. Now, for many of us, we are totally willing to engage activity towards other people that we personally would not accept ourselves on the receiving end. And that tells us that that not understanding love is not the problem, but rather hypocrisy is our problem.
I have to watch that one.
Does that make sense? So please be careful about saying, I don't know how to love, when it's a very simple question to ask yourself about love. And oftentimes we say that because our problem is not knowing or not knowing how to love, but rather our problem is hypocrisy. We're willing to allow ourselves to get away with murder while we don't allow other people to even say anything unnice, that's not nice. Literally, we allow that to occur in many cases. And that's the problem that we face, I feel. So the problem is not a problem of knowing love or knowing what the loving course of action is. The problem is that we want to get away with unloving actions ourselves, but we're unwilling to let other people get away with anything. And that is our primary problem on the planet. That's what causes the majority of dark condition once a person passed. So, for example, if these religious Catholic inquisitors in the Dark Ages, you know, in the 15th century and so forth, if they asked themselves the question, would they like to be racked and tortured to death? I can guarantee to you that every one of those would have said no to that question. They would not like it. And so, therefore, it's very plain what their actions should have been. Does that make sense? But because they were unwilling and so much in denial that they're not willing to ask that particular question of themselves, they performed a lot of unloving acts, which now they want some kind of justification for, many of them. They want to go, but nobody told me. And I cannot agree, and God, by the way, does not agree with this nobody told me thing. Because the reaction is quite simple. Would you like it done to you? If you wouldn't like it done to you, then why are you doing it to somebody else? Very simple, isn't it? Very simple rule to live your life by. And if you can live your life by that rule, you'll pass in a much better condition and you won't have engaged unloving actions while you're on earth or violent actions while you're on earth.
You've shown a lot of light to many people in the spirit world about that. There's a lot of denial.
Yes.
About what love is and how it should be executed.
Yes. And the main reason why is because they do not want to come to terms with that one underlying truth, and that is how I treat you needs to be governed by how I'm willing to accept you treating me. And if all of us governed our life by that one principle, there would... Would anybody ever go to war? Would any of you ever participate in war if you governed your life by that one? Would you like to be shot? No. So, you know, why would you want to shoot somebody else? Would you like to have a bomb dropped on you? No. So why would you like to drop a bomb on somebody else? Would you like to, you know, would you like to be raped? So why rape somebody else? You know, it just gets down to that single question of would you like it done to you? If not, then why would you do it to another person? And if we ask that one simple question, we'll understand a lot about love in that one simple question. We'll understand a lot about how we should be acting towards other people. So how do you feel when somebody's demanding of your attention all the time, for example? How do you feel? after a while, you'll put up with it for a short period generally, and then after a while you feel like, this isn't very nice, they're just demanding. So why would you then demand somebody else do the same for you? It's the same principle, but on an emotional level. And this is all we need to ask ourselves if we really want to bring ourselves into harmony with our actions, into harmony with love more. Yeah. And the reason why people are in the hells is because they have not asked themselves that one question, which is a question which is a normal question to ask. You think about it, a little tiny child, 2 years of age, has somebody come up and hit it, what's the first question it generally asks itself? Why did they do that? And if that's the question we normally ask, then surely we should ask that all of our lives. Why would we want to do that to somebody else? You know, we hurt when that was done to us. Why would we want to do it to somebody else and hurt them in the same way? It's a very simple discussion, isn't it, then? A few months ago, I gave a talk in Melbourne in Australia on ethics and morality. And it's probably worth listening to that talk in terms of gaining a bit more insight about what are morals and what are ethics, and comparing the two in our lives and seeing the effect that it has on our soul. Yeah. That's good. Francine, if you just hand the mic forward.
Hi.
How you doing?
Good. I find that since I've been on the path, I know I'm more loving. I feel more loving. Mm-hmm. But it seems that in the process, I feel a lot worse about myself. I feel like I see everywhere where I'm not loving and I'm judgmental. And how do you evolve without feeling like that sinful, depraved creature? Like when I say I'm most amazing of your handiwork, I'm going, yeah. I don't feel an amazing. It's one thing to feel the fear and all that, but how do you keep, because it kind of opens your eyes to everything you do wrong.
I agree, but this is a very important process. We need to have our eyes open to everything we do wrong. So what we need to do is go through this process of learning to see ourselves in the mirror as we truthfully are. It's like believing that we look 25 when we actually look 100, right? That's what it's like. It's a bit of a shock initially. So we can feel the shock of that. We can feel the shock of our condition. And in fact, it's very helpful to feel the shock of your condition. It's a different thing to judge it than to feel it. And this is what we've got to be very careful of. When we judge the condition without feeling it, we are capable of actions that are still much the same as we've always been capable of. We need to be able to feel the condition, like to see ourselves as we truthfully are. So that's very important. And it's very important to allow your sadness about that, to allow your sadness about what you see, because your sadness will be a motivator for you to change. Does that make sense? It will help you change. But once you feel this sadness in you about what you see, the key is going deeper and finding out why you chose that act or why you chose that particular feeling. Now, many of our feelings that we suppress all through our life have to do with ourselves. So in other words, we've been taught that we're nice and strong and everything's fine and this is something that's happened. And if you think about your life and think about the choices you've made in the past in your life, for example, becoming a lawyer is very much a choice governed by family, because it was doctors, lawyers, family, well-educated family. It's a way of maintaining a facade by doing a job that gives you a sense of self-esteem, a self-worth. And many of us actually, after we've go through the process of discovering divine truth, we start seeing actually that we don't have as much self-worth as what we thought we had, right, before we began the process. And then on top of that, we start seeing all the unloving behaviour that we have. So that gets added to the pile of the self-worth and then we feel really bad. The key is to take every one of these things to God, but not in self-punishment. So God doesn't want us to punish ourselves about what we've become. God does want us to correct what we've become. And these are two very, very different things. One is by being angry with yourself and upset with yourself about what you've become. And this is a very counterproductive thing to do. You won't get very far emotionally or spiritually doing that. And in fact, you can actually get very suicidal and down upon yourself if you go down that track. But we do need to find the emotions as to why we chose to do what we chose to do. For many of us, we are very resistive to the emotions of why we chose. We would prefer to punish ourselves and feel the guilt of having done what we've done than we would to find the reason why what we've done, because we have huge addictions involved with why we did what we did. And this is where most of us have a tendency to go. So what we do is, instead of going into the focus of looking at why we chose to do what we did, we are content to punish ourselves because it helps us avoid why we did what we did. Right? And it helps us avoid the really dark soul part of the soul that we need to feel and release. And so what we do is we punish ourselves, we beat ourselves, and we go through all these feelings of guilt and then self-punishment and self-attack. And of course, that attracts a whole group of spirits around us who are willing to just dump on us as well. And so we can get very down very quickly doing that. But if we instead had a sincere desire in our heart to actually focus on the actual cause, can you see we wouldn't go down that track? So my suggestion is, if we're going down the track of self-punishment or, feeling really, really bad about ourselves and crying about how bad we are and so forth, and not actually getting to the cause as to why we feel bad, then we're actually avoiding the cause as to why we feel bad. And all of that processing is a bit of a waste of time. Because unless you're willing to address the cause, anything you process is pretty much a waste of time. So we need to allow ourselves to see the actual cause inside of ourselves. And that requires a lot of courage a lot of the time. And it's usually our fear that causes us to revert back to self-punishment. So a lot of the times what we do when we go back to self-punishment is we prefer self-punishment because we're too afraid to actually find the real reason why we did something. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Yes, thank you.
And I suggest that's what's happening for yourself. You're very afraid of finding the real reason why certain things have been done. So self-punishment or, self-criticism or guilt is a much more preferable emotion. It's an emotion that you're taught to have right from a young age, so you're used to that emotion. In other words, you're completely comfortable with that emotion, right? But this other emotion that you're not comfortable with is an emotion that's been suppressed and denied for years and years and years and years, for some reason. And that's the emotion that you need to allow yourself to feel. So what I have a tendency to do for myself is I pray about, firstly, my fear, which is the layer on top of feeling that emotion. Mm. And when I see myself having a tendency to go into self-punishment or self-criticism or, self-condemnation, I go, okay, I'm obviously in a lot of fear here about another emotion. Because if I didn't fear that emotion, I wouldn't prefer this one that I'm used to doing. Yeah. Does that make sense?
And if you go that way, you're not going to feel like a really yucky person.
Well, no. This is where I want to clarify.
Yes, yes.
Because...
You may.
You will.
But it'll be for a short period of time.
Yeah. When you go to self-punishment, that's total avoidance. And that's just berating yourself. And it's anger with self.
Yeah.
But what I found is I liked anger with self, and it took me a long time to give that up as an addiction, because then as I get closer to the real emotional self, there's a lot of grief about self and shame about self, which is not the same as anger. It just feels yucky.
And can I point out the reasons why? Like for Mary and her childhood, there was a lot of humiliation aimed at a person who was feeling their emotions. There's a lot of humiliation aimed at a person who feeling their grief, for example, and even more associated with fear. So fear in Mary's family was laughed at, ridiculed, and even set up. You were set up so that fear was triggered and then everyone would laugh at you. So there's this process of of humiliation involved. And so it was the fear of the humiliation emotion that caused Mary to revert to self-punishment. Does that make sense? So fear of a even harder emotion to experience. Yeah.
But then on that, as AJ said, this feeling yucky about yourself doesn't really last very long as we're willing to face the big fear. And for me, it feels like a trapdoor. So I don't self-punish anymore. I'm willing to feel yucky about myself. But that's not the real cause. The real cause is under the trapdoor. That's when I hit the real pain, which is the things that happened to me that made me feel like this about myself. And that trapdoor is like big fear of the big pain is what it feels like to me. And so I spent a lot of time in the self-punishment. Then I got a bit comfy and cozy over here and I'll just feel bad about myself until I really felt, well, no, under this is really... Because in causal emotion, there's always truth. And while I'm feeling, oh, I'm bad, oh, I'm bad, oh, I'm bad, that's not truthful actually, is it? As you know intellectually, the truth is something happened to me that made me feel very bad about myself. And that is usually really painful, connecting to the truth about that. But it doesn't have to be long that you sit in the I'm bad. As AJ said, it just can, you can drop through that trapdoor as long as you face that fear. Yeah.
One thing to bear in mind always is that many of us are in complete denial about how our parents actually treated us. And we would actually prefer to believe that our parents have been great and everything's fine and there's nothing wrong with them. And even I've heard many people who've even been violently abused by their parents say, but they didn't know any different. And, you know, it's now, going back to our previous guy, of course they knew different. Did they like to be violently abused? No. So why would they then think they could violently abuse their children? You know, like, of course they know different. But they deny all of that, and they, through their rage or other emotions, they engage a process that destroys their children. Now, for many of us, we are in complete refusal of looking at what our parents have truly done. Instead, what we do is we accept their reasons for doing what they did. And we even finish up telling ourselves that those reasons are valid. Does that make sense? So we start explaining to ourselves what our parents have told us all of our lives, and that is, it's our fault that they hurt us, right? And so we prefer to go to, it's our fault or my fault that I feel the hurt, rather than going into these darker emotions relating to, you know, how we were treated. Because in that area, there's layers of anger and the fears, and there's addictions galore, and in that area, it's really like murky. And we don't like going into murkiness. We like simplicity. And the simplicity is just accept what your parents said you were and become that person. And when you can't do that, punish yourself for it. And that's where many of us finish up going, unfortunately, because we're unwilling to go into that other location. Yeah. Mm. Yeah. That's a good question. Mm. Let's see. Just go across there.
I think this is prompted by some spirits. And the question is, you keep saying that if you're very loving to others, you'll end up in a good place. So this group of spirit wants to know why they're in such a bad place. And they're saying that the feeling is that they always did everything right to others. They always treated other people with love. But they weren't treated that way, and they didn't have good self-worth or feel good about themselves, so they weren't loving to themselves. So they want to know why they're in a dark place if they did so many good deeds, so to speak.
Well, remember, every good deed that you do, for it to actually have any reward in your soul, is that it has to come from your heart for a start, not from just a rule book or some kind of principle. It has to come from your heart. It has to come from a feeling. Mm-hmm. So firstly, these group of spirits, it hasn't come from a feeling when they did good things for others. It came from an underlying belief system, that if they did good things, they'd be rewarded later, which is actually a selfish motivation. So their true motivation was based upon selfish reasons. So that's not the kind of activity I'm talking about here that we'll end up in reward. The reward comes from engaging this desire to do for somebody else what you would love them to do for you for no reason, for without a reward. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. And if I believe that I'm going to get a reward through the process, that, and I'm only doing it by engaging the reward, then I'm actually got a very false motive. And so my motivation is not pure. And as a result of my motivation not being pure, I will have a lot of difficulties when I pass. Secondly, if they are unable to treat themselves well, then it's highly unlikely they were unable to treat that they were able to treat another person well. In other words, many of the things they believe are loving, mm-hmm. right, would also be unloving under those circumstances. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So what kind of treatment did they give to themselves?
Very bad.
Let's describe some events.
Addictions, prostitution, allowing themselves to be put in situations where they would be hurt. Neglecting their body, not eating well. That's all I can really feel.
Okay. So the majority of the reason why they where they are in the spirit world is because they believe that this unloving treatment of themselves mm-hmm. was actually justified. And there is a law of compensation for that, because from God's perspective, It's the same whether I treat you badly or whether I treat myself badly. I'm still a person that needs to be treated as well as I'm going to treat you.
They feel really angry about that.
Well, that's one reason why they're in the hills, is because if they release their anger, they'll get to some fear and sadness as to why they treated themselves badly. And they will see that they treated themselves badly, and then they'd progress quite rapidly. We can talk to them more specifically if they wish about their particular issues. But the issue they're facing at the moment is they have a very strong feeling that God's the fault or other people are the fault, and they don't see it as their problem at all. And they desire to see it as other people's problem.
Yeah.
But every time we arrive in the spirit world in a certain location, it is always to do with something we chose.
Yeah, they don't really want to take that responsibility.
Exactly, yeah. And the reality is, if some of them were involved in prostitution, while they think they might have been doing their fellow man a favor, they certainly were not. Right?
Yeah.
Yep. Hmm. It's not a favorable thing to engage the sexual addictions of another person for profit.
Right. They think because they didn't initiate these things that... they don't have any responsibility for it.
Exactly, that's their problem.
Even though they were like the other end of the addiction.
No, they did initiate the things. Mm-hmm. Let's look at the prostitution issue. Mm-hmm. What they're doing is they're feeding addiction in men to have sex for pay. So who benefited with the pay?
Right, they did.
They did, yes. Mm-hmm. Okay, so... can they really say that they were being loving if they themselves and giving with no return?
Well, they say that's because of how they've been treated, that they had to do that. You don't seem to understand that. I'm sorry. I'm just telling you what they're saying.
I do understand that. What would have happened to them if they didn't engage in prostitution?
They could have been killed. Or left with nothing to eat, and they wouldn't have been able to feed their children.
Yeah.
So they think that it was justifiable that they had to do that, and that they you don't understand.
No,
how
I do understand.
Feel.
My soulmate was engaged in prostitution in one part of her life. I do understand.
Got silence on that one.
So, well, if we're going to have a discussion whether I understand or not, then I do understand. But that's not the point. The point is that even though they have justifications for taking the action they took, every justification is based on a fear that they have.
So what's the first step?
Well, the first step is firstly to see that they need to stop justifying their own behaviour that they took that was out of harmony with love of themselves or love of others. It was neither loving of themselves nor others to engage in prostitution. They did it because they were afraid, many of them. And some of them weren't that afraid and they did it for money.
Angry.
Which has both a selfish motivation. If we do something because we're afraid, we're selfishly motivated. And if we do something for money, we're also selfishly motivated.
It was just sort of like a feeling of panic as you're talking in them.
So why do they feel panicked?
Because this isn't the answer they thought you were going to give.
So what was the answer they wanted?
That you were going to understand how painful their life was and that there was some mistake how they landed in this place, in this dark place.
Yes. God doesn't make mistakes. I do understand how painful their life was. But God doesn't make mistakes when people arrive in the spirit world. The reality is that exactly the life they've created for themselves, based on their own unloving desires and passions that they engaged in on earth, will be the life that they eventually arrive in the spirit world. God does not make any mistakes. However, God does give us a chance to work through our mistakes. So we have the ability to see that we've arrived in the spirit world because of our own unloving actions and desires, and the ability to remove those unloving actions and desires from ourselves and therefore progress in our condition in the spirit world. So God gives us a chance to change as well at any time in our lives. Many of them had a chance to change when they were on earth and they did not take the chance because they were engaged in some of their selfish addictions. So many of them had an opportunity to stop prostitution at different times of their life and they chose to continue it. This is an indication that they were unwilling to look at their own responsibility.
And then there's just a couple of them that are saying, if you keep saying we're all so messed up because what of our parents did to us, then why is this our responsibility?
Well, many people have had terrible parents and yet never chosen to go to prostitution or to go to murder or to go to another act that was unloving. It's still a choice what we decided to do with the injuries that we had. We can choose to feel our injuries that we have and release them, or feel them and just feel them rather than hurting another person. In their case, they chose to hurt other people. And that is an unloving act.
Yeah, and if they're very honest with themselves, they're pretty angry.
Really angry. Like the whole time, this is me, Liz. The whole time you were talking, I just feel all this anger at being projected at you. Mm-hmm. And they wanted me to say, but I actually chose not to, that they really wanted to hear from Mary. They were like almost tired of hearing you talk.
Yep, that's
but
fine.
I was just like, I'm sorry, I'm not saying, telling them that one because you're going
to
listen.
I'm happy to hear from Mary, but I'm pretty sure she's going to say the same
thing. I'm just going to say the same things, except I'm going to say they're not being honest because I can feel how angry
thing.
They are.
Yeah. It's like against
and
men.
And that's in the prostitution. They're saying they had no choice, but many of them chose to stay with it because they were in a rage with men and they could feel
and they liked the power it gave them over men.
Yeah. So they're not really being honest about their motivations.
Very unpleasant.
Yeah.
Very angry.
Yeah. And while they retain this anger, they will stay in the same place in the spirit world as they've always been. It's only when they are a bit more honest with themselves and look at their actions that they have personally taken and their desire to manipulate and control men through prostitution that they'll actually start to, you know, see their, you know, why they are where they are right now. Mm-hmm. Now, I agree that they've had quite difficult lives when they're on earth before they entered prostitution. but it was still a choice they made. Mm-hmm. And Mary in the first century made the same choice, but she's also made a different choice in the first century as well.
Yeah. So. If they look at my life, then they would see that I had to take responsibility for the emotions that I was avoiding in doing those things and the anger that I had. And if they can see that, they'll see that I had to go through quite a process of becoming more real with myself and then repenting for how I'd harmed other people through those processes. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And a whole bunch of them are getting what you're saying, and then there's a group that's just stomping their feet about it. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
Yeah. And, oftentimes when we do take unloving actions towards other people, we want to justify it. We want to get all enraged and have this righteous justification of why we chose mm-hmm. to do what we chose to do that was unloving. The reality is that God's laws work perfectly.
Yeah.
And if we're in a dark condition in the spirit world, then it's because of unloving choices we have personally made, mm-hmm. not because of the unloving choices that other people have made. So we need to understand this if we're ever going to progress.
So if they were to come back to me at some other time, I would just keep trying to help them and talk to them the way that you are and teach them. And
we can understand what they're going through, mm-hmm. but we cannot agree with their position of maintaining rage towards God and men. When they themselves chose to take unloving actions that engaged them in the things that they engaged with. So, they need to look at the rage they have with men and the rage they have with God and start working their way through that particular mm-hmm. those particular groups of emotions if they're ever going to get out of the dark place they are currently in.
Am I channeling them just because I'm a medium or because I have some compatibility issue?
You have a feeling inside of you mm-hmm. that's supportive of them in the sense that you feel anger towards men is justified.
If you've been hurt by men.
Well, it doesn't matter whether you've been hurt by men or not.
No, I'm just saying
it. You still believe it's justified.
Okay.
Because the reality is you're willing to be angry with men who have never hurt you. So you actually believe mm-hmm. anger with men is justified. If one man hurts you, then you believe being angry mm-hmm. with all men is justified. And this is something that they believe, exactly the same kind of belief, because they took out their actions on other men that did not hurt them. Mm. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So certain men hurt them, mm-hmm. then they decided to take those actions out on other men who did not hurt them. And you have exactly the same emotion inside of yourself where you're willing to take mm-hmm. out actions upon other men who never hurt you mm-hmm. based on the hurt you feel from different people that have hurt you. Mm-hmm. And these are compatible emotions, and so you feel justified, or their condition is justified.
So any spirits that come to talk to me, I should look and see what... they wouldn't be able to talk through me if I didn't have some compatible issue.
Oh, no, you can get into a condition of love, and any spirit would come to talk with you then. But usually there is an association initially of the type of spirits that will come and speak. The spirits that came and spoke with Mary earlier, mm-hmm. who have been following us around for some time to want to speak, really have been mirroring Mary's emotions quite strongly, in that Mary mm-hmm. was going through, if you want to explain. Okay.
Yeah, well, I was going through a huge resistance to feeling my fear, my terror. But also what I realised by the end of the channeling was Tiffany's strong emotion about feeling humiliated. She was very confronted about being emotional in front of other people, and that's certainly an injury that I have. And just the terror of being out of control. Yeah. I felt, though, that there was an attraction happening for the group also, and I was interested to hear about the reflections anyone had. If they saw themselves in this idea that she decided that she had developed by actually being in total denial of fear, and actually she was terrified. So I felt at one point during the channeling this huge resonance with everyone, and it was like, oh, I can hardly maintain a connection because everyone just wants to not look at this issue. And then I just kind of got through that bit. But yeah,
I can't remember exactly when that happened. I don't know if you felt that as well.
Yeah, and particularly when I mentioned that many people on earth think they're on the divine love path and think they're actually working their way through things, when the reality is they're still using the same technique, which is suppressing the particular emotion in preference to feeling like they are progressed. And it is a difficult issue to face for many, you know. Mm. Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
No worries, Liz. It's always good. Go straight behind you.
Hi.
Just hold it close.
Hi, AJ and Mary. Great to be here with you.
Yeah.
I have a question regarding the law of compensation as it relates to children.
Yep.
So let's say a young child is acting out, is being violent towards other children, for example.
Yep.
And they're reflecting the repressed anger of one or both parents.
Yep.
How does the law of compensation relate to that child, or is it more relating to the parent or both?
Well, it depends on a lot of circumstances. It depends on the age of the child. So the younger the child, the more the child, the parents have to take responsibility for what's actually occurring. Also, the child could be overcloaked by a spirit who's actually encouraging the child into violence. And under those circumstances, the spirit would be the person who is having the law of compensation effect, most of the effect. So it just depends on the circumstances as to why the child is acting in the manner and the age of the child that's acting in the manner and the kind of emotions that the parents and the spirit surrounding the parents actually have. A lot of the times it will be shared between environment, the parents, the spirits with the child, and then there will be a small portion of it going towards the child itself. And then as the child grows and becomes a teenager and an adult, then obviously the proportion assigned to the child becomes greater and greater because they actually have more recognition of society-based bad behaviour. So in other words, our society generally accepts that violence towards another person is not acceptable. Now, that being the case, by the time the child becomes a teenager, then there is a general acceptance in the child that the society around them believes that violent behaviour is unacceptable. So if the child, as a teenager, was still engaging in violent behaviour, you can see that now the child has more of a personal responsibility for the choice that it's making than it had when it was 2 years of age and goes up and bops their friend on the nose, you know. And this is what we also need to understand. You cannot make any rules about what happened. God assigns, all of God's law assign actual compensatory effects to every single person involved. Every single person involved. And many times, by the way, there are things happening right on the other side of the world right now that we personally here are actually having a compensatory effect of our own soul about, because we refuse to see our part in what we're creating. So, for example, when America is involved in a war in Afghanistan, then many Americans have a law of compensation effect on their soul as a result of that particular event, as a result of their particular unhealed emotions that they allow that event or they agree with that event or they have some kind of reasons for wanting that event to occur, including driving around with cheaper petrol, for example. So even if we desire to drive around with cheaper fuel and we go to the cheapest service station and pick up our fuel, this is part of the emotion that drove America to war
in Iraq,
for example. Yeah. Does that make sense? And so, therefore, each of us engaging that particular act bear some responsibility for the underlying choice that the government made to engage in that particular action. So it's very, like, you can see that any event that we observe happening in the world that we personally see come to us as an event, we need to firstly question ourselves and say, how have I participated through my emotional condition? How have I participated in this action?
Mm. So, if you go back to the child, the example with the child, to me it's a question of will. So how much of the child's will is actually activated for themselves? And also how much of the will of the people surrounding in the environment, the parent, the spirit,
is involved in what's happening. So if a parent is actively using their will to suppress their anger, and the child hardly has a knowledge of the fact that they have will, then most of the compensatory effect is with the parent. Now, as the child, like AJ was pointing out, as the child grows and begins to have more of a concept of their own will, then the compensation is acting more and more on their soul. But it will always go back to, there will always be compensation for the parent until the parent heals what they have done to create this condition within their child. There will always be a compensatory effect. So even if the child's 65 and the parent is 85, then there'll still be compensation upon the parent if they haven't healed what caused that effect in the child.
And does that make sense, Lawrence?
I'm starting to get it, yeah. The question I had was, let's say it is a two-year-old child who kicks the cat. Okay, it's an act of violence, but it happened because the anger was being reflected by the father, let's say. Mm-hmm. Does that child incur some kind of soul damage to some degree?
Well, that's,
as Mary said, though,
the law of compensation is the soul damage that they would incur. So if they have no concept of their own will, if they're very small and they're simply reflecting the suppressed emotion of the parent, of the father, then all of the soul damage goes for the father. The more they understand about their will, the more goes towards them, or the more they're actively using their will. But to just finish what I was going to say, if I saw a child acting out in this way and I was the parent, there would be two things I would be looking at. One is, as AJ said, how has my emotional condition created this for the child? But second, especially if I'm the parent, how can I teach the child through this experience about their will? Because ultimately the use of their will is what is going to, in the long term, create their soul condition. So from the moment, especially as a parent, from the moment the child incarnates, one of my biggest jobs would be to help a child understand that they have will, and that when they use their will in disharmony with love, it will, in the long run, affect their soul condition. Yeah.
So it's like the negligence of the parent could be an act of violence in a way.
Exactly. Yes. Yep, exactly. Yeah. We often are negligent as parents to teach our children principles of love because we personally don't want to engage those same principles. Mm-hmm. And so we then teach our children to not do it. And I see many parents, for example, not at least attempting to teach the child about the loving use of its own will. So many parents say, the child should be let to do whatever it wants. I can't agree. God doesn't let you do whatever you want. God has consequences assigned to every action you take. And if you do the same with your own children, then you're just creating a monster, to be frank. And then, of course, that monster, whatever that monster goes ahead and does, will be quite a large degree attributable to your own lack of action as a parent. Mm. Yeah.
Thank you both very much.
No worries. What is the time, by the way? Can we just... 8:35. Yeah, we need to finish shortly. So, across this way, excellent.
Hello.
G'day. How you doing?
Good. I have a question. When I was 13, I discovered that I had scoliosis, curvature of the spine, and ended up having spinal fusion rod in place, and it has been my challenge since. Mm-hmm. And in your discussion earlier, I was thinking of the connection, and I want to make sure I have it clear. Mm-hmm. One, that at that age, probably more to do with my parents' unprocessed emotions.
Yes. And also spirit attachments.
And spirit attachments.
As a result of the parents' unprocessed emotions.
Yeah. Okay. And it was the center of my body, so I'm assuming both... Mm-hmm. Parents were involved.
And what location in your body had the main problem? What location in your spine?
From my neck down to almost my entire spine.
Right. Was there any part of your spine that was unaffected?
Just a few vertebrae up at the top and a few at the bottom.
Right. Yep.
And I'm also, my concern as well is passing this unprocessed emotion to my children.
Yes.
And one of my children has a lot of anger. And I know there's, on my father's side, just a huge history of violence and...
What's the gender of the child with a lot of anger?
Male.
Male. And what are your feelings towards men?
Well, at the moment, I've done a lot of healing around it. So, and I have a wonderful husband, so I have a lot of love. But in the past, it's been not love.
I would suggest that what you've just said is not the truth, because your son is reflecting something completely different.
So that would be something to look at.
Yes. Yeah. You see, a lot of the times we would like to believe that we've sort of sorted out certain emotions, when in reality what we've got is exactly what we want. So let me illustrate. If you have some anger towards men, then you get a man who's really loving towards you, then of course he's not going to expose this anger that you have towards men, because he will be pandering towards you. He will be wanting to do what you like or want. Does that make sense?
Right.
What's happening in your family? Do you have a husband who does what you want quite frequently?
He's very loving towards me.
Absolutely. See, you got to be careful here with your definition of love. All right. Can you see how you're almost saying that a person who does things for me all the time is going to be very loving towards me? And I can't agree with that. Your definition, this is your definition of love. But your son is demonstrating that something's wrong with this definition. Because if your son was feeling love from his mother, he would not be reflecting anger. Do you understand?
Right.
So there's got to be some kind of suppression of the male that's occurring in your family for your son to be acting enraged. So that tells me, and I can feel your emotion anyway, but that tells me, even from a logical perspective, that there's got to be something going out of you towards the male that causes the male to feel this anger and reflect it. Who does he reflect it with mostly?
Me.
Exactly. Can you see he's not reflecting it a lot with his father, but reflects it more with
he
you?
He does sometimes, but...
Sometimes with father, most of the time with mum.
But mostly with me.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. This is telling you that something is not healed with regard to your attitude with men. And what I'm saying to you, which is what something you don't want to accept at this point, is that your attitude towards men is that they are very nice men when they do exactly what you want.
Right, I hear that.
Yep. And
well, I have a lot of trust issues with men.
Of course, yes.
Yeah.
And this is why you want to find a man who does exactly what you want, and then you feel happy. But the reality is your son is reflecting that things aren't so happy inside of yourself. Otherwise, he would be feeling a love from you, and therefore he would not be angry and reflecting this anger at you all the time.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this is the beauty of having children, is they reflect the truth of your condition, not the condition you imagine.
Right.
Right. So remember, the question I asked you at the beginning was, what are your feelings about men? And you said, can you remember?
Yeah, I said that. In the past, I've had a lot of issues.
So, but, and that you said?
Presently, I was feeling loving towards them.
Exactly, and I can't agree with that.
Yeah, and I mean, in talking to you, I'm... Like, I know that I still have a lot of anger, and I see that in my son, and I know that it has something to do with me.
But do you understand that a lot of this anger is suppressed in you easily because you are actually living with a man who does many of the things you want him to do, and therefore he does not trigger your anger with men.
Right.
Can you see?
Mm-hmm.
And so you feel that it's all resolved, but it's only because you've purposefully desired a man who you can control and manipulate to a large degree, and he automatically engages that because he feels quite natural with that process. And that's what he's been taught to do by his own mother, to treat women in this conciliatory fashion. And as a result of that, he has got some suppressed anger, but he doesn't even notice that either because he feels it's the right thing to do and the correct thing to do.
Right.
But the fact that your son is mostly angry with yourself tells you that it's to do with the emotion coming from yourself rather than from your husband that he's responding to.
Right.
Does that make sense?
It makes sense, yeah. And I still have my father in my life to remind me of my anger towards men.
Yes, and this is where it's very important to not try to convince ourselves that something is resolved when our, you know, life and the law of attraction is demonstrating otherwise. It's very important to become face to face with what is happening in your life as a demonstration to you that something is wrong. And if nothing was wrong, and it was all to do with his dad, which is something you'd like to believe, right? Then that his dad has some suppressed rage towards women. That's what you would like to believe this is about. And then he would be reflecting this emotion with his father, not with you.
Right.
Do you understand?
And then what do I do to heal this?
Well, firstly, look at whether you want to heal it or not. The reality is there is this tendency in you still to believe that you'd like it to believe it's somebody else's issue, not your own. And this is the starting point. So that says that there is not a strong desire in you to heal this emotion. Instead, there is a strong desire in you to have the male do what you want. And that's not a desire to heal the emotion. That's a desire to control the male so that he no longer harms you. Does that make sense?
To avoid the terror of being harmed. Yeah.
And so if you allow yourself to just ponder about that and pray to God about developing a desire to actually heal the emotion itself rather than developing a desire to get everyone around you meet the addiction of the emotion. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So at the moment, the desire is more to get everyone around you to meet the addiction of the emotion. My suggestion is to pray to God about releasing that as a desire and actually having a desire to actually deal with the hurt that is there with your dad, right? Because that's the mm-hmm. primary source of this particular problem, which is the hurt that you feel with dad. And allow yourself to have a true desire to deal with that hurt that you have with your father. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
As you have a true desire, the attractions will ramp up. You know, you'll get more men showing you that what the actual problems are. And then if you can allow yourself to feel the what's really going on rather than attack the men or respond in an angry manner, instead, look at it from a different perspective and actually begin to feel, you know, the sadness that is present within you about what dad's done, then you'll go a long way to healing it. And as a result of that, this emotion of anger towards men won't be coming out of you. And there's a feeling of injustice in your son where he feels that just because he's a man, he's getting treated badly. It's a feeling coming from him, from you towards him. And once you release that, he will no longer feel that feeling. And so your measurement as to whether you're addressing the issue or not will actually be the amount of anger that your son has specifically with you. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And then as that anger lessens, you know, I'm on the right track now. I'm getting better, right? And then as the anger lessens so much that eventually your husband's the one that gets most of his anger, then you know it's your husband's turn to deal with some of this feeling that men are less than women, right, that he needs to address. And once you both address those particular emotions completely, you'll find that your son will be very gentle with the both of you. Yeah.
It is a good question. Mm. And can I add as well, at the moment, like you kind of know there's anger with your dad. And you can sort of almost connect.
And you can feel even the grief that you feel with him, hurt.
Yeah. Something I've noticed in my own processing is that when I'm not fully owning that emotion, say I'm angry with my dad, then I feel angry with all men. And it's a projection out of me towards all men. But as I come closer to owning the emotion,
I can still feel angry with Dad. Like, it might not be fully gone, but I just don't feel angry with men all the time. I just feel angry with Dad. And also, there's not a projection coming out of me towards all men. And so this is also a way that you know you're getting closer to the truth of what's happened to you, and the real pain is, even when your son's, you know, you might not feel like, oh, I'm done with anger with Dad, but your son shows it less to you. So you're, oh, hang on, I'm honing this into the real truth now, to the real cause.
Yeah.
And that's a good place to get to, because you think, ah, you know, it's not hopeless. There is progress. I still feel angry, but at least I'm going in the right direction now. And if I keep just being humble and owning it, I'm going to get to that terror, and then I'll get to the grief. Yeah, yeah.
So emotionally, if you think about it, when you place the emotional responsibility on the person who created the problem inside of you, rather than placing the emotional responsibility on every man, then obviously that's a condition of higher truth. Because it was only certain men, or one man even, that might have caused your particular issue. Does that make sense? While it's going out towards all men, there's a unloving behaviour going out to all of the men who have not treated you badly. And that's where the compensatory effect starts occurring on the soul, but it's also where your son reflects. Ah, he's reflecting that I blame all men still, not my father. So, and the reason why we have a tendency to do that is because we still want love from the person who hurt us. And so we have a tendency then to not associate the hurt with the person who hurt us, because we still want love from that person. And if we truly associate the hurt with that person, then we probably not want them in our lives, or, you know, any of those things. And if we do that, the beauty of doing that is that all the other men who unjustly feel our attack now we'll feel much happier in our company.
Yeah. And if we go back to that trapdoor thing I was saying to Francine, got it already, but I was saying to Francine earlier about there's a real terror about feeling where the pain originated from. And that's because we go back to experiencing it really entering us. But also there's the second factor that AJ just pointed out. We have to, in that moment, give up the false belief that they loved us, and give up the hope that they're ever going to love us, and just feel the truth of it. And that's why, you know, we almost prefer to project it out at every other man rather than just face that really big fear of the pain and the you know, the hopeless feeling we felt as a kid, that I'm not being loved. Yeah.
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 We have a generally deep resistance to associating the hurt with the person who hurt us, because at exactly the same time, we want the person to hurt us to change.
Yeah.
So that they no longer hurt us. And this investment that we have in our relationship with them causes us to start blaming everybody else but the person who hurt us. And unfortunately, when we do that, then obviously there's not a lot of very good consequences that happen when we do that. It's far better to associate this hurt with the actual person who hurt you, and then go through the process, which eventually will result in forgiveness of that person, rather than like make out that that person never hurt you, and then automatically associate the hurt with every person of the same gender, or similar characteristics. Yeah. Anyway, it's probably time to finish off now, I feel. So I don't know how you feel things went tonight. How'd you feel about Mary's channeling? Was that fine? That you could. That's good.
It was a bit uncomfortable to channel. They were quite intellectual and resistive. So,
So over the coming few days, we'll try to channel a few different groups of spirits with different issues and problems. But also, we may eventually finish up engaging some spirits with questions that you would like to ask as well. So we might be able to do that over the next 2 days. So our session tomorrow will start about 1, and we'll probably have a break about 3 o'clock or so. And I understand the food situation here is there's no food situation. Is that?
Yeah, I think we can bring our own snack, but it's not a
not
share.
Allowed to share.
Sometimes
it.
We do a share thing,
yeah.
But that's not on here. So,
yeah,
so is that right? Yeah.
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 So you'll need to make your own arrangements for food tomorrow. We'll have a break about probably 3-ish to about 3:30, quarter to four. So there's a bit of time for a break there during the middle all course of the day. Thanks for your time again tonight,
thank
guys.
You,
it's good to catch up with you, many of you again. And for those of you we've met for the first time tonight, very enjoyable to meet you tonight. And we look forward to getting to know you a bit better over the coming couple of days.
Yeah.
Thanks for your time.